for dispute resolution and for testing equivalence of regulatory frameworks. My lords, in the world of international trade, there is no entirely free lunch. In relation to the FTA, our report described two of the most comprehensive FTAs the EU already has with third countries. Its trade relationship with Switzerland, which is complicated and is based on over 100 bilateral agreements within that framework, and the very recent, and not entirely implemented yet, EU's comprehensive and economic trade agreement with Canada, known as CETA. Although CETA has been branded as the most comprehensive FTA in existence, our witnesses were quite clear. Existing FTAs, including CETA, do not provide anything like as comprehensive access to the single market for businesses as membership of the single market as such would entail. In a free trade agreement, UK manufacturers, for example, may well have to comply with the rules of origin. These, in fact, imply levies which are imposed by importing nations on the components of goods which originate outside of the country. Exporting such goods would cause complications for most of our manufacturing industry. We also conclude that an FTA with the EU would have to be of unprecedented depth in order to provide anything like the near level of market access for UK service industries. My lords, there are great complications in the services trade, and most FTAs do not in any detail cover trade within the service sector. They more or less talk about equivalence of regulatory frameworks. There is therefore no precedent in any relationship the EU has with other countries, third countries, that gives us much guidance as to how an FTA would look in relation to the EU. FTAs do provide a great deal of flexibility. We would, of course, not have to accept the principle of free movement, nor would we have to accept the jurisdiction of the Court of Justice. But, my lords, we would have to ensure there was a high degree of regulatory equivalence and that we would have a joint arrangement in order to settle disputes. We then also considered how the process of negotiating such an FTA would be operating. And this was the area where we had greatest reservations about what appears to be the government's current position. In the context of the tight two-year deadline imposed by Article 50, we concluded that experience demonstrates that the FTA negotiations within the EU are complex and slow-moving. All our witnesses were unclear to downright doubtful whether the UK would be able to negotiate such an FTA in the same timetable as the UK's withdrawal from the EU. Ministers continue to say that they would hope to do so. Almost everybody else told us that, in any case, the EU27 and the Commission are likely to take the view that these negotiations would have to be undertaken separately and staggered. There would be a divorce agreement, and until that divorce agreement covering such contentious issues as the budget and acquired rights was completed before we could move into negotiating in any detail a free trade agreement. Even if we had the outline commitment to a free trade agreement, the complexity I have described would take considerably longer to negotiate. My lords, we did therefore recognise that the conclusions would be not only complicated, they would also be part, probably, of a wider agreement which the government would have to reach with the EU. My lords, there are other issues than trade, issues of security, of criminal justice, of climate change, and so forth, of cultural and foreign policy relationships, and possibly mutual arrangements on migration. And that would be highly desirable if we did have a very comprehensive agreement. But that, of course, is even more complicated and likely to take even longer. Accordingly, we recommended that the government should urgently consider where the negotiations, and be clear to the nation, where the negotiations on a UK-EU FTA could be conducted in parallel with withdrawal negotiations. And if not, and probably even if, whether it would seek a transitional trading arrangement in order that the full details of negotiations could be worked out. On the issue of the transitional agreements, the government's response is that we will not seek a form of unlimited transitional status. Rather, we expect a phased process of implementation. Well, nobody was calling for an unlimited transitional phase, but phased implementation clearly relates to an agreed end. What we are saying is that at the end of the period of negotiating withdrawal, which in effect is considerably less than 2 years, we will not be starting until the mandate has been given by the Council of Ministers to the Commission, which will probably be June. Even then, heavy discussions will probably have to await the German elections and to be completed before the European Parliament elections. We are therefore talking about a period considerably less than 18 months. On the issue of the transitional arrangement and in the absence of clarity from the government's position, I would therefore ask the Minister if she could clarify tonight what the government's view is on the relationship between the withdrawal arrangements and the negotiation of a free trade agreement and on the need for a transitional arrangement. My Lords, the other reason why the now discarded EEA option remains relevant is that it illustrates what the EU has sought in the past or found acceptable in a pretty comprehensive trading relationship it has with those three EFTA countries. It includes a mechanism to transpose changes in EU laws into domestic legislation on an ongoing basis. My Lords, we are about to see a great repeal bill which will in effect put EU laws into British law. That will mean at the port of departure we will have more or less harmonised or equivalent regulatory structures. It's what happens beyond that that the government will have to ask, and the government, the EU is likely to have a starting point that it will require the same of us as it has required of the EFTA nations. Frankly, my Lords, there's not much reason to suppose that the EU's starting point in negotiations will be to offer the UK a significantly more favourable term than it does to those EFTA countries. There is one other thing I just mentioned before I sit down. This report is, of course, about UK-EU relations. But those relations are also important for the prospect of deals with the rest of the world on which the government is embarked, and for the sequencing of events. For all the talk of doing deals with Mr. Trump or with New Zealand or with India, whilst preliminary discussions can no doubt take place, no deals can be signed until after we leave the EU Customs Union and the Common External Tariff. That is not simple. Even if scheduling what are currently EU tariffs as provisional UK tariffs at the WTO may be relatively straightforward, we will then have to unravel from EU arrangements. And until we do that, it's not possible to conclude other deals. Because not only is it unclear if third countries who are currently party to an FTA with the EU will be prepared to offer the same terms to a market of only 60 million that they offered to a market of 600 million, it is also technically difficult in many cases because many EU tariffs also have tariff quotas attached to them. And this particularly applies to agricultural and commodity trade. And since many third countries, including New Zealand and the USA, are big in agriculture, as are India, Brazil, and most of the developing countries, the allocation, the divvying up of those tariff quotas is going to be a very complex early stage in negotiation. So this has implications for trade with the third world, as well as with trade with the EU as such. My Lords, the report is not all doom, and it's not all gloom. Merely we're saying it is difficult, and the government have to recognise that it's difficult and gear up to tackle it. We were a bit critical of the capacity of the government when we discussed this back in December. I think we've been reassured to some extent that the government are getting their act together across Whitehall now, but it is a colossal task. And I would welcome anything the noble lady, the minister, can tell us about how it is going, how the build-up of Whitehall expertise and capacity and coordination is building up. To conclude, my Lords, our report is but a snapshot of the debate. It covers different paths than they are now likely to go down, but nonetheless, I think it remains instructive not only about the realities of trade in the modern world, but also highlighting the trade-offs and the deals on sovereignty and mechanisms that will need to be done. And it also, I think, brings the House up to date on the complexity and the size of the tasks. My Lords, I beg to move. Yeah.
The question is that this motion be agreed to.
My Lords, I'm extremely grateful for the opportunity to debate the report of the External Affairs and Internal Market Subcommittees of the EU Select Committee, and it's a great pleasure to follow the speech of the noble Lord, Lord Whitty. We've worked very closely with him and his committee on this joint inquiry, and the noble Lord has laid out with great eloquence a number of key areas that have been provided by witnesses in evidence to the committee, but also the range of questions that the committee has put to the government. So I won't repeat many of the areas that the noble Lord has already alluded to. But as the chairman of the External Affairs Committee, I would like to start by also extending my thanks to the members of the committee and for their important and considered contribution to this report. And I'm really pleased that many of the members of the committee are here today supporting this debate, and many of them are contributing to it. I'd also like to put on record our thanks and appreciation to the Secretariat, to Eva George, and to the policy analyst Julia Ewart for their assistance and diligence throughout the inquiry and for the preparation of this report. It hasn't been easy. It is a difficult one to bring together, and I think they have done a sterling job with the clerk and the members of the Internal Market Committee. I'd also like to put on record my appreciation and thanks to our specialist advisor, Holger Hestermeyer, for his expertise. It made invaluable contribution to both the committee's work and the report, and also to our wider understanding of some of the smaller, minute details of the work that the government has got to undertake. As the noble Lord, Lord Whitty has said, future trade with the EU after Brexit is a hugely important issue. The EU is the destination for 44% of our exports and the source of 53% of all our imports. The terms of this relationship will be fundamentally changed by our exit of the EU. We're entering into uncharted territories, so in this environment, the role of Parliament in investigating the implications of Brexit and in scrutinising the government is extremely critical. The committees have sought to provide a balanced and thorough overview of the issues that are likely to arise from the four main options for trade. And as the noble Lord, Lord Whitty has said, the EU committees will further be publishing detailed reports on trade in goods and trade in services next month. But in this debate, I'd like to focus on two options, not covered in detail by Lord Whitty, but he has mentioned them in his opening remarks. And that's the implications of leaving the customs union and trade under World Trade Organization rules. So turning first to the customs union, as we set out in the report, the customs union prohibits customs duties and non-tariff barriers on imports and exports between member states. It forms the single market in goods. So, my Lords, this has significantly benefited cross-channel trade and facilitated the development of integrated EU supply chains in many industries. And I'll give two examples. One, the chemical industry, and second, the automotive industry. We have heard that great attention has been given to the government's stated intention to negotiate its own trade agreements after Brexit. And since we published our report, as the noble Lord, Lord Whitty has said, the government has confirmed its intention to leave the common external tariff and forge new agreements with third countries. My Lords, in our report, we concluded that addressing tariff barriers within an FTA could be relatively straightforward, notwithstanding the short timescale to negotiate an agreement. But replicating the prohibition non-tariff barriers to trade while outside the customs union will be more of a challenge. This includes compliance with rules of origin, regulations and standards. And a second issue in leaving the customs union will be costs and delays resulting from customs procedures and any added administrative burdens. Since we published our report, the government has, as has been alluded to, ruled out our membership of the customs union in the model of a Turkey, a non-EU country. It has also stated its intention to achieve frictionless trade with the EU. Currently, it is unclear how this can be achieved outside a customs union. However, our forthcoming report on trade in goods will consider and probe these matters in greater detail. It'll be interesting to understand much more clearly what frictionless trade actually means. My Lords, my second objective is looking at the World Trade Organization options. Establishing the UK's independent schedules at the WTO is a matter of first order concern. The UK's WTO schedules will be the baseline for the rest of our trade with the EU and with other trading partners. I'm pleased that the government has confirmed that work is underway to begin this process and that it will seek to replicate the EU's existing schedules. The government has told us that this process should be a largely technical rectification process, and so relatively straightforward. Whilst I hope that this is the case, as we noted in the report, politics and events can sometimes intrude into such negotiations. While establishing UK schedules swiftly may be UK's priority, other members of the WTO may seek to use this process to seek further concessions and clarifications from the UK. Notably, negotiations on tariff rate quotas for agricultural products. These often prove to be protracted and complex to resolve. My Lords, the government has said that it recognises the need to increase human resources and expertise within government, and the noble Lord, Lord Whitty, has said that we're pleased that the number count is going up. And I'm assured that the government is working to increase not only staff numbers, but capacity at the Department for International Trade. However, we concluded in the report that its current staff headcount is relatively modest compared to the ambitions of the government to begin preliminary discussions on FTAs with a range of third countries. It is crucial that in that light, and looking at what other current partners have already have, that we see the capacity and resource issue addressed urgently. I reiterate the view of the committee that establishing the UK schedules at the WTO alongside negotiations with the EU should be the government's priority. The UK's WTO schedules will be the foundation of its independent trade policy. Future FTAs with countries such as the US cannot be concluded, of course, until the UK has left the EU, and so work by the Department of International Development should be sequenced accordingly. If, as we concluded in the report, the UK is unable to agree an FTA with the EU within the two-year Article 50 process, as has been raised by the noble Lord, Lord Whitty, we will trade on WTO terms. The government has said, in its views, it's very clear, no deal is better than a bad deal. When the government describes the scenario of no deal, trade under WTO terms is the reality. Trade under the WTO terms is the reality. And I'll just elaborate a little further on this. Trading with the EU on the basis of WTO schedules will involve a considerable change to UK's current conditions for trade. Tariffs would be imposed, non-tariff barriers would no longer be prohibited, and there would be no provisions for many important services traded by the UK. This could be extremely damaging. The government has been clear that this is not the outcome that it seeks, but while we must aim for the best possible outcome from the negotiations, rigorous planning is needed to understand the impact of no deal. That is, trading on WTO terms with the EU in order to help business prepare for this as a possibility. This also highlights how important it will be to secure a transitional arrangement, as the Noble Lord, Lord Whitty, has said. The government's position, as stated by the Prime Minister on the 17th of March at Lancaster House, and in its response to our report, it has been somewhat unclear. It has ruled out what it terms an unlimited transitional status and instead proposed a phased process of implementation. Now, my lords, this may be a case of semantics. Well, at least I hope it is. UK businesses need a bridging agreement which begins immediately after our current terms expire. I urge the government to seriously consider negotiating a transitional arrangement as it begins those vital negotiations with the EU. My lords, in recognising that there is a lot of work being undertaken by government, the Prime Minister has excluded membership of the single market and the EU's customs union, there still remains considerable uncertainty. So can I ask my noble friend the Minister to tell the House how they will assist business in managing the transition into a new trading framework? And could my noble friend also provide a more detail to the content and feasibility of the Prime Minister's approach to the customs arrangement? My lords, I look forward to hearing from my noble friend the Minister.
My lords, it's a pleasure to follow the noble Baroness Verma and indeed my noble friend Lord Whitty, who as chairs of the two subcommittees that came together guided us very carefully to get as clear a report as possible. And I saw this inquiry as really a straightforward attempt to set out the myriad of relationships that there are currently between the European Union and other countries, and the costs and benefits of each approach, so that the wider stakeholders and public, as well as the government, could actually begin to see some of the things that will need to be negotiated. As I've said before in this House, I am learning a lot on these committees. And that every meeting I come out of, I think this is much more complicated than anybody anticipated, and certainly, I think, than anybody understood before they were able to place their cross on the 23rd of June last year. And I, of course, approached this inquiry, as I approach most things, from the prism of the region I come from, the North East. Trade is at the centre of the relationship of the North East to the European Union, and indeed a higher proportion of exports from our region go to the EU than from any other region. And these exports are almost exclusively manufactured goods, although there are, of course, services that often go alongside these goods. But we export more per capita of manufactured goods than anywhere else in the country. I'm shortening my speech because of the time, but the North East does have a positive balance of trade, which is the healthiest in the country, and I'm sure the government won't want to lose that and won't want to neglect that really important thing, because of course the North East is, I suspect, from every criteria, one of the areas left behind that the Prime Minister talks about so much. The government, in their response to the report, make it clear that they're actually not going for any of the models that are outlined in the report, although they do accept that they have to prepare for the no-deal option, which would be reverting to WTO rules. And they've already, before triggering Article 50, ruled out the option that the majority of manufacturers wanted, and that is continued membership of the single market and the customs union. So that means that the struggle to actually meet their expectations is going to be even greater, and I hope that the government accepts from this report the challenges that any new deal is going to bring. None of them are cost-free. None of them are, taking back control continually, as Lord Whitty said. And the real problem that crawls out of this report is that nothing is for nothing. The government have been to date incredibly optimistic, but sometimes it seems, and I have to say their response to this report reinforces this view, that they are not being wholly realistic. What manufacturers are looking for is as much clarity and certainty as possible. I accept that it's not possible at this stage to provide that fully for either clarity or certainty. However, the government has a responsibility to actually respond to those ambitions as much as possible. I've met no one in the EU, and the committee have met people from the EU, both in relation to this report, but many other activities in recent months. No one wants to be, they don't want to be vindictive towards us. However, their prime ambition, it seems to me, is to make sure that the EU survives and hopefully prospers. And if they think that the UK is seeking a deal with no difficult consequences for the UK, that it's all going to be wonderful in the way it's often described to us in government speeches, then I think that they're going to look at that with a great deal of caution. Yeah. They do not want any other country to feel that we will get a better deal than they have, and that therefore it is worth them seeking to leave the EU. Yeah. And we have to remember that in the way that we negotiate and approach this. I suspect, and the report reinforces this, that the devil will be in the detail, and that the framework for future relations that will, of course, have to be spelt out in the leave document that we normally refer to as the divorce settlement, that will simply not be able to explore the detail. And in this case, and of course, I do not believe that a transitional deal will be able to do anything but. The government seems somewhat coy to acknowledge this, and they say, again, as Noble Lord Whitty said, they expect a phased programme of implementation following the Article 50 process. Frankly, I don't care what the government wants to call it. What we need, and what manufacturing industry in particular needs, is some clarity that there will be a process put in train after the 2-year limit, which will deal with the detail in a way that doesn't put them at the cliff edge. I know that's the government's ambition, but they are going to have to establish the game plan, as we say in the report. I'm normally an optimist, being a woman in the Labour Party and a Sunderland supporter, you've got no option. However, I'm finding this very difficult.
Yes,
I don't accuse the government of false news, although I think a lot of the campaigning for the referendum could be described in that way. But I do caution them about being so optimistic to the extent that it appears blasé. The worst outcome will be to raise expectations that are then distinctly underachieved. That's not in the interests of the country, and I might say especially the North East. I hope that the Minister recognises that we need a dose of reality in this debate. It's going to be a long, tough road ahead. Yes, we want the best outcome, but this is a negotiation. And whilst we may be one of the largest countries in the EU now, we are not in sole control of these negotiations. We need to approach them realistically and with humility.
Yeah.
My Lords, can I also add my thanks to the two chairs of the subcommittees and also to the staff of Parliament who assist us in making this report. The noble Lord Whitty, in his opening remarks, referred to the picture which has moved quite rapidly since this report has been written. And, of course, it's rather like having a snapshot as taken out of a moving picture. And so, therefore, I would like to concentrate my remarks upon the government's response to this report, which I think are very pertinent, and there are many issues which I think we could probe very deeply. It seems to me, my lords, that the government has issued all departments with a sort of lexicon of words that it must use in respect of everything to do with our relationship, future relationship with the European Union. To name a few: ambitious, comprehensive, frictionless, phased implementation, and I must say, definitely not my favourite, and I even have trouble pronouncing this because it doesn't appear in any dictionary, facilitations. Facilitations, my lords. But I did look up the one word, which I think was the one which has been used very frequently, and that's frictionless. And the Oxford Dictionary describes that as smooth, achieved with little difficulty, effortless. And I wonder whether the government, therefore, has given out the wrong book, because it's using these words to their analysis of the huge challenges ahead. But I'm somewhat amazed, in fact, I'm absolutely amazed by the level of the ambition, given the timescale into which the government seeks to meet its own objectives. I'm also concerned by the way the use of the words return of sovereignty are used as an underpinning ambition to be reached. Any free trade agreement, my lords, involves trading off interests in one area to gain another. And by their very nature, free trade agreements involve losses of sovereignty. The alternative is building barriers. And I am reasonably confident, that the government doesn't wish to build a wall, physical or otherwise, around the UK, not least because that would mean a definite and dangerous return to a hard border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. My lords, there is no example in the world of a significant economy that has both market access and absolute sovereignty. So I think it's very appropriate to ask the Minister, how does the government reconcile its response to this report, which states that it wants, I quote, the freest possible trade in goods and services, and at the same time, to take control of its own laws? Now, the government in its response to this report states that our future relationship with the European Union will be very complex. In fact, I would say that was very much an understatement by the government. It says it will be wide-ranging and will apply to both trade and non-trade issues. And it quotes justice, defence and home affairs as examples. And the House of Lords report looks in detail at the wide spectrum of matters that will need to be dealt with in terms of the UK-EU trade. And all this is to be agreed within the timescale set by Article 50. The government hopes that it not only secure the framework for the new relationship with the European Union, but also deal with both departure and future arrangements simultaneously. So, my lords, on the assumption that only the framework will be concluded in the timescale available, given that's what's actually in Article 50, it would be useful if the Minister could outline in her response what is the government's understanding of how close a framework comes to a fully worked out set of arrangements, particularly in the area of our new trading arrangements with the European Union. But the timescale, my lords, for negotiation is not going to be 2 years. Given the requirements for achieving the agreements of individual member states and the European Parliament, many months will need to be sliced off the end of the 24 months to achieve the 2-year target. And some have suggested that negotiations therefore could be concluded in 18 months. But as just been said in this chamber, there are likely to be some slicing off at the front end of the timetable as well, as elections and future the politics in both France, Italy and Germany take their part. So I would be grateful for the Minister to give your Lordship's House the government's view on how many months they will actually think they will get to conclude an agreement to exit and the framework for the new relationship with the European Union, whatever that framework might contain. My Lords, this brings me neatly to the issue of transitioning and phased implementation. I recognise in its lexicon that the government has found new words for the period which follows the 24-month exit period. It says it does not want unlimited transitional status, but a phased process of implementation. My Lords, the introduction of the word unlimited is interesting, and I'd like the Minister to explain what is meant by it. For example, does it mean the UK doesn't want unlimited time to complete the new relationship? Or does it mean that it will only be seeking transitioning in some limited number of areas? Or does it mean it wants to limit the need for any changes to be made during the implementation phase? I simply don't understand it, and I'd be grateful for an explanation. Yeah, yeah. In all other respects, I think the use of phased implementation and transition are virtually indistinguishable. So this brings me in turn to one aspect of transitioning which will definitely be needed, and that's our trading relationship with third countries. The committee report makes it perfectly clear that the UK cannot conclude trading agreements until we have ceased to be a European Union member state. The report also makes it clear that the UK would be unlikely to be able to retain access to the European Union's free trade agreements with third countries. So, can the Minister confirm that this is likely to be the case? It was a question raised in the report. It was a question not answered by the government in its response to that report. At the point of exit, we would be facing a cliff edge for our trade with third countries. The government's response to the committee recommendation on this matter says, we are exploring ways to achieve avoiding a cliff edge, but then fails to give the certainty that there are possible routes available to us. So I must ask the Minister directly, what ways are available to the government to ensure continuity of trade with third countries on the day of departure from the European Union? I'm not asking for the government to give us its preference, but simply to outline the choices which are available to it. And there's a very practical issue here for which, as the report points out, certainty is required by UK business. We recognise the need to invest in greater trade negotiation expertise. Unfortunately, the government's response to this matter in the report is to provide a set of bald numbers, 300, 350 building up in departments. But what is needed to understand this properly is what skills has the government got now available to it. By way of example, there was a question asked again in the report, how many new experienced trade negotiators have recently been taken on by the government? Where have they come from? What level of skills now does the government have available to it? And the government's responses on this and other trade matters lead to far more questions than answers. And I believe it would be necessary for your Lordship's House to continue to throw light on these issues which face us. I commend the report, and I look forward to the upcoming reports on trade in goods and trade in services, which will give another chance for this House, British industry and our people to examine these critical issues of our future well-being as a country.
My Lords, Lord German had great fun, I think, with the sort of lexicon of terminology which the government has clung to, ministers are clinging to like a life raft. I think one recognises here all the subtle skills of a Sir Humphrey in collating the incompatible. But to be fair to the government, absolutely fair to the government, they have come up with a clear plan in the shape of the white paper, which we're now all familiar with. But I would remind it, the government, and also the House, of the words of Mike Tyson, the boxer, who said recently, everyone has a plan until they get a fist in the face. Now, I mean, the fist in the face will come with the shock when we find out exactly what the European Union thinks of all this. And we don't know. We have some idea. There's a talk about a £60 billion euro bill for a start before even discussion can take place. But I hope it's not too big of a shock, even as professional an advisor, Sir Ivan Rogers, did say that we should be prepared for some sort of standoff after the initial discussions take place, and I think that is what may well happen. Now, the merit of our report, speaking as a member of the committee, is that it lays out for the trading goods the various options, the single market, the European Economic Area, a UK, EU, free trade area, a customs union, and a World Trade Organization rules. And can I too thank both our chairs, Lord Whitty and Baroness Verma, for their role in getting us through all this, and also the staff for a very, very difficult job in marshalling this really extensive material and trying to understand it. I do now understand what a diagonal accumulation of rules of origin at least I did understand for 5 minutes this morning what it was. I'm not sure I could repeat it shortly after, but I do think that we did try to explain to the world at large exactly what was involved in these various options. But we also went on to make two recommendations and bits of advice, I may say. The first one, already been touched upon by Lord German, which is the whole business of, we did really seriously say that this cannot be done in the time available and we need some sort of transition period. And I think the government, to be fair to the government, they have grasped this point and they're using the phrase implementation. We come back to this question of language again. We do explore this further in our second report, which is about to hit the stalls. If I can give a trailer to that, which is fascinating reading, just as our first one was fascinating reading. This is equally fascinating reading. So I think the government has grasped this point, that there is a very short time period. The second is we advocated staying in the customs union, not the single market, of course, which is impossible, the government's ruled out, but staying in the customs union, at least in the transitional period, while it is all sorted out. The White Paper, of course, does reject this, saying that it wants instead a new customs or free trade arrangement, a bespoke arrangement, a unique arrangement for the UK. Now, this is not impossible. For example, Wolfgang Schäuble, the Germany's finance minister, has commented on this and said, indeed, the model which the UK might look for is the arrangement which Switzerland has with the European Union. But, of course, we should remind ourselves that Mr. Schäuble is a notably good friend of the United Kingdom. He said it's reported that he shed tears when he heard the referendum result. So he's a friend, and there might be others who are rather less friendly and have rather more influence at the time we are negotiating these things, which he may not, of course, be in post as a finance minister any longer. So we can't rely too much on that. Nonetheless, it is certainly possible. However, if that is not possible, if that is not cannot be negotiated, we either have to go back to the customs union or rely simply on the World Trade Organization rules. And of course, the World Trade Organization rules do present us with a problem. First of all, as David Davis apparently said to the Cabinet Subcommittee, looking at all this this week, all the bureaucracy of government has to be re-engineered in a very short space of time to be ready for that period, no less than 2 years from now. All the companies have to re-engineer all their arrangements, particularly those with complicated just-in-time supply chains. That will be an absolutely major undertaking. But not only that, but we are looking to replace the certainties of a large market, free trade market on our doorstep, with only the possibilities of free trade agreements with other countries, which may be take a long time to do, to complete, and also may not give us as much in total trade as we are leaving if we do not continue to be members of the customs union. So there is no doubt, there is absolutely no doubt that this is a huge gamble, and we do, my Lord, live therefore in very perilous times when it looks. When you look at it this way. Now, some in these circumstances predict disaster, and some say we will have a bumpy ride for a few years, and after that is out of the way, things will be better. Now, in my experience, in situations like this, certainty is usually misplaced. And I say that particularly as an economist who's quite often found the predictions that I've made in good faith and on my expertise have turned out to be wholly wrong. And people far more illustrious than I have made even more certain predictions, which have been even more certainly proved unfounded in the light of events. Even the greatest of experts, resembling Michael Gove's view of experts, have come unstuck in all of this. So I confess that I do not know what is going to happen. But what I do know is a great deal will depend on the choices we make in these areas in the trade negotiations we are about to enter into. Success in politics, in my view, is usually having a good combination of courage and judgment. And I can only hope that my colleagues in government are able to show both the courage and the judgment to steer us through these perilous times.
My Lords, I'm pleased that we've got the opportunity to debate this report, and I'd like to thank my noble friend Lord Whitty for his skilful steering of the two committees and, of course, the noble lady, Lady Verma, through a complex subject. The Secretariat have done a marvellous job in presenting the options for trade with clarity and thoroughness, and I'd also like to add my thanks to all those who submitted evidence, whether in person or by correspondence, for sharing their knowledge and wisdom. In my contribution, I want to say something about the timing and context of the report and why its recommendations are still valid, as my noble friend Lord Whitty has said. I also want to explore what precisely is meant by open-mindedness in the context of the government's approach. It's 75 days since our report was published, and most of our hearings took place in September and October last year. Some would argue it's been taken over by events, in particular the Prime Minister's speech on the 17th of January, where she said, "What I am proposing cannot mean membership of the single market." It's important to remember that when the subcommittee saw the noble lords Bridges and Price on the 13th of October, we were told that the government was, quote, "looking at all the options," close quotes, and was, I quote, "not ruling anything out," close quotes, for a future trading relationship between the UK and the EU. And we took that statement on its merits and looked at four options, their implications and risks, and this is set out in our report. It's my contention that, although the politics may have changed, it does not invalidate our report or its analysis. The risks are still there and the uncertainties are still there. And following the Prime Minister's January speech, the White Paper was published on the 2nd of February. And it says in the White Paper, "We have an open mind on how we implement new customs arrangements with the EU." It's not my intention to put the noble lady, the Minister, on the spot. I can appreciate that the open mind of the 13th of October is very different from the government's open mind of the 2nd of February, and she has her instructions from her boss. But in our report, we say, we therefore had to adopt an open mind, and following chapters consider all four potential framework. And I think that our mind was genuinely open, my lords, and I believe we carried out that remit. From a personal point of view, I regret that two of the four potential options have been ruled out by the government. And two key recommendations in the report are about business confidence and the need, as the noble Lord, Lord German said, the need for a clear game plan for future transitional agreement. We referred to the fact that businesses are operating in conditions of considerable uncertainty, which was a significant threat to the UK economy. And I think our report is clear that business confidence is of the utmost importance. And in these days where international compliance on quality, standards, country of origins agreement and dispute resolutions are the norm, it makes nonsense of the kind of free trade buccaneering of Mr. Patrick Minford's world, for instance. Will the noble lady, the Minister, give us an assurance that industry will be fully consulted and involved in the negotiations, and that will be a government priority? And secondly, we recommended the need for the clear game plan, and it could be argued that the Prime Minister's 12 principles are as clear a game plan as you can get. But they're not principles, they're objectives, many of which depend entirely on the agreement of others, and I think the government accepts this. When I was chair of ACAS, I would see many so-called principles presented by both sides of industry. The trouble was, they were never the same. That's why language is going to be extremely important. And looking through the government's belated response to our report, much of which is a reiteration of the White Paper, I welcome the emphasis on dispute resolution and am duly impressed by the volume of contacts with interested parties listed in the annex to the letter. And I particularly welcome the statement that we do not want to undermine the single market and we do not want to undermine the EU. We want the EU to be a success and for its remaining member states to prosper politically and economically. There are some Europhobes who would delight in seeing the dismantling of the EU. So this statement by the government is important. Finally, my lords, there is an intriguing answer by the government to recommendation 3 of our report on the World Trade Organization. It says, and I quote, "As we leave the EU, we will be the more able to play a full role in underpinning and strengthening the multilateral system." So we're leaving the EU to take over the world. Now that really is open-minded, my lord.
Yeah.
My lords, having made my maiden speech last October during the debate on championing free trade, it feels appropriate to speak again today to welcome the excellent report produced jointly by the EU subcommittees chaired by my noble friend Baroness Varma and Lord Whitty. Having missed the opportunity to be the 180th speaker during the second reading of the Article 50 bill last week, it also provides an opportunity to share some broader reflections on Brexit. In particular, I'd like to focus on the central issue of how the dynamics of the trade negotiations might unfold once Article 50 is finally triggered. With all due respect to your Lordship's House, I believe we have spent far too much time on the process issues, at times generating more heat than light, and today's debate allows us to get into the substantive and tricky issues which lie ahead. We should ultimately be comfortable in granting the Prime Minister maximum flexibility to negotiate unencumbered. We can do so in the full knowledge that the success or failure of this negotiation will make or break her premiership, as signalled by her rare appearance on the steps of the throne last week. Put simply, the Prime Minister will have the clearest of political incentives to carry Parliament and people with her ahead of the 2020 general election, which will serve as a de facto referendum on the outcome or define the negotiating parameters for the remaining process should the timetable extend beyond 2 years, which seems highly likely, as noted in the report. Much of the debate during the committee stage of the Article 50 bill this week has boiled down to different views on the art of the possible once negotiations commence. So instead of speculating, I say, let's get on with it. I've spent 25 years negotiating large and complex corporate and financial transactions, but these pale into insignificance compared to the heroic and daunting task ahead. It is now clear that we are seeking to conclude an unprecedented free trade agreement with deeper preferential access to the EU single market across both goods and, importantly, services than is currently enjoyed by any third country. Indeed, it is likely to form part of a wider association agreement encompassing other non-economic areas of cooperation. So all the apparent hyperbole is more than justified. This will be the most ambitious and complex trade treaty of all time, particularly if it is going to deal effectively with the alternatives to a customs union, not least in Northern Ireland, and the equivalence and or mutual recognition issues for services. My Lords, let's drill into how we might persuade our counterparts to conclude such an unprecedented FTA, and also consider if we are overestimating the strengths of our cards. We must certainly be ambitious, but at the same time make an honest assessment of whether our starting positions are realistic. The UK government position is built on four pillars of logic. Firstly, the Article 50 process and the FTA should be undertaken in parallel, since the withdrawal process is intended to take account of the framework for the UK's future relationship with the EU. The other obvious reason for linking the two processes is that we can then maximise negotiating leverage from any divorce settlement. Secondly, we start from the position where all the rules and regulations are identical on day one, with zero tariffs, and so unlike most trade negotiations, we are not seeking convergence. The Great Repeal underpins this position from a legal perspective. What is therefore important is to protect against divergence, and so the dispute resolution mechanism will be key, which is why the government white paper includes a whole annex of such examples. Thirdly, we can achieve all of this in 2 years, and therefore any transitional arrangements are not designed to extend the negotiating time period, but simply to provide an implementation buffer. The actual negotiation period, as mentioned, would in fact be shorter, something like 18 months or even shorter than that, if we include the process for approval by both the European and UK parliaments. Fourth, if we can't get the deal that we want, we will fall back on WTO terms, and this represents what expert negotiation theorists call the BATNA, or best alternative to a negotiated agreement. In contrast, my lords, the EU position is clearly at odds with our own starting position. On the first pillar, Michel Barnier has made it clear repeatedly that the EU proposes a sequential process, Article 50 first, followed by the new trading arrangements. I believe the current standoff can only be unblocked by the European Council in their negotiating mandate to the European Commission in response to the formal triggering of Article 50. Without this course correction, the negotiations will get off to an acrimonious start, and it will remove the leverage inherent in our monetary settlement. On the second plank of our argument about starting from a unique position of trading conformity and offering zero for zero tariffs, we are placing huge faith in homo economicus, that rational decision making will prevail. Having had dinner in Brussels with senior European leaders earlier this week, I'm not sure that they see it entirely this way. Brexit was a political choice, and it will receive a political response. The EU is determined that Britain pays a price for leaving the club, not out of vindictiveness, but because they fear that a favourable deal for Britain would create a bad precedent and potentially encourage other member states down the same path. So they clearly want us to pay a price, while we naturally want to minimise the economic impact. Put crudely, can we get away with a slap on the wrists, or will it be a slap on the face? I believe we will not really know until much later in the process, when all the big contentious items are on the table and we progress to the 11th hour horse trading. There is significant risk that the arrival of Macron in France and Scholz in Germany could embolden European hawks to play hardball. There is also a big bear trap waiting for us, clasping at what might appear to a relatively attractive deal on goods, where the EU runs a trade surplus, but a relatively poor compromise on services, where we enjoy our biggest competitive advantage. I'm afraid that standing up for city interests is clearly unfashionable, but I do hope that protecting the £66 billion tax base that pays for essential public services is something that we won't trade away lightly. To secure a preferential deal on services, we will inevitably be asked for some form of preferential access by the EU to the UK's new immigration policy. So we must define this as a matter of priority. On the third area, relating to the timetable and transition, a big expectations gap is opening up. The government is quite understandably targeting 2 years to conclude the whole process. It would certainly be in our national interest to minimise the period of uncertainty. However, all the empirical evidence and expert opinion is stacked up against us, and I do fear that ministers are creating a rod for their own backs. It seems more likely that within a 2-year time frame we can conclude Article 50, including our new WTO schedules, alongside a substantive framework for the future trading relationship and how to reduce customs friction. But more time will be required to complete and ratify the FTA. In these circumstances, a strictly time-bound transitional phase would be extremely valuable. This would not just be about implementation, and I note that Lord Bridges has sidestepped the question of temporarily remaining the EEA, but this option, or something more bespoke, could provide a bridging phase from one regime to another. We will also need this phase to replicate all 53 third country FTAs. I can only assume that the government's logic is driven by the desire to keep maximum pressure on timing, and that a traditional period which elongates the timetable is a fallback, and any such proposal is tactically better off coming from the EU. I do believe that there is a significant risk that the government will ultimately be forced to retreat on both timing and transition, and so perhaps it might be preferable to hedge its bets. Fourth and finally, we come to the fallback position that no deal is better than a bad deal. The EU, like EU, is likely to view it in a diametrically opposite way, namely, any deal is better than no deal. Why? Because the cost of abrupt exit is significant. From where we stand today, it would be the Grand Canyon of cliff edges, and therefore falling back to the WTO will be seen as an empty threat. So, as Sir Ivan Rogers pointed out in his evidence to the House of Commons Brexit Committee last week, no other major country trades on pure WTO terms with the EU. Since WTO doesn't cover services in any depth, it is doubly disadvantageous for a country like the UK. We will be walking into a legal vacuum in many areas. So, my lords, on all four pillars of our negotiating strategy, we have some serious work cut out to win over hearts and minds. The honest assessment is that we don't hold many cards, and face a negotiating asymmetry of 27 versus 1 set against a ticking 2-year clock without an easily palatable fallback. Put starkly, we need to buy our way or charm our way out of this situation. Fortunately, our surprisingly resilient economic position since the referendum provides us with some room for manoeuvre on the financial settlement, particularly if the amounts can be stretched out over time. It is also crucial to galvanise the goodwill amongst our European partners. In the words of Simon Fraser, speaking at the Worshipful Company of World Traders last week, we need to avoid gratuitous political friction. This is not a time for gifted amateurs, but for serious and professional negotiators. We might also need to draw upon the mediation skills of leaders and countries that enjoy the trust and respect of both the UK and the EU and can see the benefits of enduring non-economic cooperation across Europe. The voice of European businesses will also be important in focusing the minds of national governments back onto the economics and not just politics. I would suggest to the government that this wider advocacy mission is not just for ministers, and we should actively draw upon the expertise and Rolodex of the House of Lords in reaching out to parliamentarians and key influencers across Europe. In conclusion, my lords, to achieve a successful, smooth and smart Brexit and secure the most advantageous trade agreement going forward, we will need to have our checkbook ready and, above all, make efforts to win friends and influence people as never before.
Yeah. Follow the noble lord, Lord Gardner, with all his experience of the city, and extremely wise words, I thought, in his speech. I have to say, as a public sector crossbencher, I feel rather uncomfortable being sandwiched between the noble lord, Lord Gardner, and the noble lord, Lord Green, but I will do my best. I very much welcome the report, and congratulations to the noble lord, Lord Whitty, and the noble lady Verner, and their committees for producing it. And it's good, I think, to have the discussion now about the future relationship between the UK and the EU, because rather like the noble lord, Lord Horam, I have some suspicion that when Article 50 is triggered, the attention will switch, at least for a while, towards the rather more exciting prospect of the short-term withdrawal negotiations, and in particular focus on the much heralded €60 billion figure, which may or may not come forward from the Commission. I hope nonetheless that the negotiations, that those negotiations will progress, and that attention will turn again to the negotiation, turn again both in public and during the negotiation, to the longer term relationship between the UK and the EU. Like others who have spoken tonight, it seems clear to me that, and it's quite clear from what the government have said, that the prospect of remaining in the single market is not an option which is going to be open to us. The government's commitment to at least some control over the levels of migration from the EU and its concern to avoid ECJ jurisdiction rules that out. I have to say I regret that, but I think that is a fact. I had hoped, my lords, I have to say, I had hoped that the government would keep open the option of staying in the customs union, which would have guaranteed tariff-free movement of goods, if not of services, and also would have eased the difficulty of managing the border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, which, although I'm very glad that that issue is mentioned in the government's response to the report, I still feel is not given anything like enough attention, and I hope that it will get more attention in the future. But the government have not as kept the customs union options open, or at least they seem not to have done so. I have to say I'm not quite sure what the government is now hoping to achieve as far as its trading relationship with the EU and its trading relationship with the rest of the world. If I can quote the Prime Minister's speech on the 17th of January, she said, "We want to get out into the wider world to trade and do business all around the globe." Well, that is an aspiration, but I don't think it's really a policy. And that has been slightly more fleshed out in the recent white paper, but I hope that the noble lady, the minister, can say in her response to this debate a little bit more about the government's intentions, both as regards the relationship with the EU and its relationship with the rest of the world. My lord, I want to make three points in what time remains. The first is that if the government does not succeed in reaching agreement on its negotiating objectives, then it does risk getting pushed back, as others have said, onto WTO terms. Now, I've heard it argued that this would be no bad thing. It would provide business with certainty, perhaps. But it does not seem to me that the kind of certainty that is the kind of certainty that business, and in particular the jobs that depend on business, will need. So I hope the Minister can also tell us a bit more about whether resort to the WTO terms really is envisaged as a desirable or even a plausible fallback if, as I hope is not the case, the negotiations do not succeed. My second point, my lords, concerns dispute resolution. The government clearly does not like the ECJ and, in particular, its direct effect on UK law. But dislike of the ECJ does not mean you can do away with dispute resolution. The key point here is that any international agreement, again, as has been said so far in this debate, any international agreement, or virtually any international agreement, and certainly any trade agreement, has to have some form of dispute resolution. And the WTO has its own dispute resolution mechanism, and the EU and the US, and the US and China, and the EU and China have resorted to it when necessary in the past. And so will the UK, if and when it has trade agreements which lead to disagreement, as inevitably it will have. Now, my lords, I have deliberately used the past tense when I said that the US has had recourse to WTO dispute resolutions in the past, because I have seen, as I'm sure others have, the reports in today's press that the US may be thinking of not accepting WTO dispute resolutions in the future. I have to say that I think that is a profoundly worrying development, and it would make our position outside the EU if there were no dispute resolution within the WTO, no effective dispute resolution in the WTO, even more lonely than I fear it would be when we leave the, as I think we will, when we leave the EU. And my final point is perhaps the most important. There sometimes seems to be an assumption behind the government's rhetoric that with one bound we will be free from the constraints of the EU and the constraints of the single market, which incidentally, as others have said, takes 40% or more than 40% of our exports. And we should be able to trade easily through new bilateral trade agreements with China, with the US, with India, with Australia, with Brazil, and with others. But, my lords, these are all tough potential partners with a clear sense of what is in their interests. Those and other countries will negotiate what they want out of negotiations and not what we want out of the negotiations. So such negotiations will be tough, protracted, complex, and at times ugly, and it is no use pretending otherwise. My lords, I don't favour another referendum on the EU. I would have wished the result of the last one to have been different, but I accept it. But I echo what the noble lady, Lady Armstrong, and others have said in this debate so far, that the road ahead, particularly for trade, will be hard and long and gritty.
My lords, as has already been recognised, since the report, events have moved on. The government has set its course, aiming for a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement and a customs agreement with the EU and a range of FTAs with other markets. More generally, the government has proclaimed an aspiration to become the standard bearer for Britain to become the standard bearer for open trade policy. This is to be the new global Britain. And there's much to be saluted in these aspirations, even by one such as myself, who believes that we should have remained in the EU. Apart from anything else, there is a fundamental difference between this approach, the approach of the new Brexit Britain, and that of Trump's protectionist version of America. You didn't hear at any stage in the referendum campaign rhetoric about cheap Chinese imports, for example. I want to make a few points, all briefly, not least because some of what I was going to say has already been covered. Firstly, the deep and comprehensive free trade agreement and the customs agreement with the EU. Yes, of course, that is now going to be critical as the centrepiece of the government's strategy. As has already been underscored, this is something unprecedented. This will be more ambitious than the ambitious Canadian agreement, than the South Korean agreement, more ambitious than the Ukraine agreement, which we did look at in the course of our deliberations. Different too from the Turkish Association Agreement. In a sense, more than all of these put together is the mantra, and it is going to be something, at the end of the day, sui generis. Unprecedented, of course, does not mean impossible. In fact, technically, it has often been argued, and there's clearly an element of truth in this, that the starting conditions make it easier to achieve than was the case in any of the others that I've referred to. We start, after all, from a position of considerable harmonisation, certainly in the goods markets and increasingly in the services markets too. So technically, this achievement not of convergence, which already exists, but of the avoidance of divergence should be easier.
Politically, however, it's not going to be straightforward. As has already been mentioned, from the EU perspective, this deal cannot be as good for the UK as the status quo. If it were, others might be tempted to say, as Philip Snowden is reported to have said in 1931 when Britain dropped off the gold standard, "I didn't know you could do that." It's also going to be difficult for Her Majesty's government because the dispute resolution process is almost certainly going to have to involve in some way the ECJ. Certainly on the EU side, there is no way to avoid that. My second point is one that again has been made by a number of other noble lords and baronesses. There is close to no chance of accomplishing all this in 2 years. The Canadian deal took somewhere between 7 and 10. The Japanese agreement is going surprisingly well. The Japanese discussion between the EU, with the EU, that is going surprisingly well, but it's already into its third or fourth year and is clearly not going to be completed anytime soon. The complexities are enormous, and they're not just about the short-term distractions in the EU elections, the high priority that will undoubtedly be attached by the EU to the budgetary questions and by all of us to the acquired rights questions. All of these mean that it's going to take some time, but on top of that, these trade discussions with the EU are related to other trade discussions, inevitably, and this is true on both the UK side and the EU side. The existing EU FTAs may be questioned by their counterparts. The South Koreans and the Canadians, after all, both signed deals with a market that included Britain. Will they want to review those agreements in the event that they're no longer getting access to the British market? Then there's the question of new agreements that are in process of negotiation now. I've referred already to the Japanese one, and this is the most important case. The noble Baroness, Baroness Armstrong, has mentioned the Northeast and its high export propensity per head. Those exports are, of course, very largely of cars to the EU market. And therefore, I am sure that the Baroness Armstrong would want to join with me in asking the Minister whether the Department of International Trade has given careful thought to the impact that the successful conclusion of an EU-Japan deal will have on the UK-EU discussions. Thirdly, there is the all-important question of Ireland. My Lords, we have debated this at great length earlier this week. But unlike everything else in the Brexit discussions on trade and investment, this is not just about commerce, and could not be treated as one item in a shopping basket for a negotiation where inevitably trade-offs and compromises get made. Because, of course, it's about the peace settlement, and if it went wrong, a human tragedy could result. Ministers have confirmed on a number of occasions that they attach a very high priority to the maintenance of a seamless, open, frictionless border on the island of Ireland. And I wonder if the Minister, in responding to in this debate, could confirm that this means that there are really no circumstances in which we would sacrifice that question on the altar of a very good free trade agreement in other respects. Fourthly, the phased period of implementation in which the UK and the EU and the Member States prepare for the new arrangements, to quote from the Government's response to our report. This has been commented on by a number of speakers. What's in a name, you might well ask? Well, a rose is just as prickly by any other name. The fact is that this is going to take a considerable number of years beyond the 2 years of the Article 50 discussions, and I wonder, in company with a number of other speakers, whether the government wouldn't be better to say this outright and to set a period, not an unlimited period, but let's say for the sake of example, 5 years, during which there is a transitional agreement and in which time, knowing the eventual direction of travel towards a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement, the discussions can take place in the orderly manner that they will need and over the time frame that it will necessarily take. And finally, my Lords, I want to raise a broader and deeper issue. Global Britain will want to think of itself as a nation of traders. Indeed, we've heard that expression. We want to think of ourselves as outward-looking and entrepreneurial, ready to take on the wider world. But as of now, we're more what Napoleon said we were. We're a nation of shopkeepers. In fact, we have too few companies engaged in exports. We have market shares in some of the fastest growing markets in the world that are behind those not only of Germany, but of France and of Italy. And the growth statistics this week produced by the Office of National Statistics show how unbalanced the current growth pattern is in this country. We have a yawning trade and current account deficit, which has a long history to it. We have an import penetration problem such that the devaluation of sterling is blunted and tends to translate all too quickly into higher rates of inflation. Rhetoric won't change this. Neither can monetary policy and fiscal rectitude alone change this. We need to face up, therefore, to one of the most basic lessons of the Brexit vote. And that is that Britain has lived for half a century, not only with an increasingly unbalanced economy, but with an increasingly unequal society, and that these two trends are related. For we have failed over decades to invest properly in the country's societal future, above all through the education and training needed to enhance life chances and social mobility. Changes in the nature and structure of the economy in the latter decades of the last century have played their part in this. And the radical change in technology, which is likely to transform the economy over the next few decades, will exacerbate the challenge. The last generation has seen the British economy become more dominated by services than any other major European country. Others have seen the manufacturing decline as a percentage of national output in the face of newly globalised competition, of course, but none as steeply as Britain. And as the share of manufacturing shrank from the 1970s onwards, apprenticeship training, which was the principal route into the good intermediate skilled jobs that are the backbone of any effective manufacturing industry, was allowed to wither on the vine. The so-called hourglass economy has not done away with the need for intermediate skills. And in fact, we are gradually building up a significant skills mismatch. An unbalanced and unfair system of preparation for adult working life has produced plenty of low-skilled workers and not enough intermediate skilled ones, such that by the year 2022, on present trends, 9 million low-skilled workers could be chasing 4 million jobs, whilst there's a shortage of 3 million workers needed to fill some 15 million higher-skilled roles. In an underinvested economy, which has seen no material growth in labour productivity, economic growth overall has failed to increase average prosperity and has been possible at all only because of skill gaps have been plugged through immigration. This is not sustainable, and the social implication of these imbalances are certainly unacceptable. This is a complex problem with deep roots, both societal and economic. The Social Mobility Commission's report on the State of the Nation 2016 documents in sobering detail how a disadvantaged start in life feeds through to weaker average educational performance from the earliest years onwards, into less access to tertiary education, less support for vocational development routes into adult working life, and into a labour market where the supply-demand equation is increasingly weighted against the low-skilled. Does this all seem irrelevant to the question of trade? I hope not, because it's actually fundamental to the question of our long-term ability to succeed in trade. In other words, and finally, there's a lot more to the strategy for the successful development of the new global Britain in its trade position vis-à-vis the rest of the world than just trade deals. A major priority, surely, has to be long-term, properly resourced skills education strategy. It's not easy. We have failed looking backwards over several decades to do this well. We need, dare I say it, to be prepared to learn from some of our European friends who do this so much better than we have done.
My Lords, I very much welcome this report and the debate that we're having, and indeed I very much welcome the thrust of the remarks just made by the noble Lord Green of Hurst Pierpoint. are indeed training, educational standards and so on, comparing us with the Germans, is one excellent feature of the closer European integration. The concept of benchmarking best practice in Europe, our nearest neighbours, is a huge factor in what has been undoubtedly a relative success story, let's say, of our membership of the European Union since 1973, when we joined the EEC. My noble friend Lord Whitty said at the start that he was perhaps a little sorry that this report was not being debated before the 2 days of committee this week. Well, the plus side is that we who sat through most of those 2 days, Monday and Wednesday, Monday and yesterday, can add some reflections arising from that debate, which are very germane to where we are today. I moved the First Amendment on Monday to do with the retention of our membership of the European Economic Area, at least get it onto the map that everyone understands we are members of the European Economic Area, which is by virtue of our membership of the EU, and it would be retained if we were a member of the other pillar of the EEA, that is EFTA, even though leaving the EU as was required by the result of the referendum last June. I must say that one of the things that I am looking for, as perhaps in vain, but I am looking for in the next few months, is that we will all expect the public debate to become much more ruthlessly realistic about the options. I hope my noble friend Lord Whitty doesn't mind me describing him as ruthlessly realistic in chairing this report, but it is what we need. We still have too much of cake and eat it, Alice in Wonderland, and indeed, when we go back to the referendum question, what people voted for was totally obscure. It was, as we all know, a mélange of things which were in people's minds. But certainly, the idea, it came up yesterday, I think, oh, well, we voted for maximum access to the European single market, not membership of it. Oh, and so that was on the ballot paper, etc., etc., etc. And this ruthless realism is absolutely vital to avoid what Field Marshal Montgomery would have called a dog's breakfast at the end of it. I don't know whether breakfast rhymes with Brexit, but anyway, it'll have to do for the moment. I actually think it's rather irresponsible to have an imbalance in the debate which the government has somehow got to answer for, which is that on the one hand, things are ruled out in this speech or that speech. You see a bridge, you blow it up. It's ruled out. But nothing's ruled in. Nothing is ruled in. So the number of things that are there still to be looked at seem to get less and less and less until you're left with only one. And that one, of course, is the same as all the others. It's got downsides as well as upsides. And let's, in the spirit of ruthless realism, acknowledge that all of the options have downsides as well as upsides. So we've got to evaluate them all against the background of that recognition. Taking account, for example, of some excellent points made by my noble friend Lord Mendelssohn on Monday. We're going to hear from my noble friend Lord Mendelssohn in a minute, and I always pause before making sure I haven't got the two pronunciations mixed up. But Lord Mendelssohn made an interesting speech on Monday. I think it was Monday rather than yesterday. I think it was Monday. But anyway, Monday. Let's say it was Monday on anyway. Which was that the sort of agreement that the government now thinks hopefully they can get would give us far less economic bangs for the buck than the arrangements that we have got at the moment. In terms of world market share, and let's reduce all this to one slogan, we are in the business of maximising our world market share. And so the central question is, what short-term, medium-term and long-term maximises our world market share? That is certainly how the Germans see it. It is certainly how the Japanese see it. And one can't quite summarise how the Americans see it at the moment because it's very hard to make the thing add up. But there is, in the way in which the debate is becoming rather abstract, a denial of what Lord Mandelson also said in an interesting phrase. We're talking in Europe not about just a vast trading area, but one vast factory floor. Now, as a former trade union official, I'm designing what you might call the framework of agreements for multinational companies on a whole string of things, which is the way much of the world now operates. Not as many strong trade union agreements as we would like, but conceptually it is clear that you don't want to race to the bottom, you want some minimum standards, and even long-term training investment, for example, you can't just have people poaching each other's labour. And this is what happens if you don't have any rules. Now, talking about rules, I must mention the metaphor level playing field because there seems to be a belief that we want a level playing field at the same time as we don't want a referee. I thought that the metaphor about a level playing field either referred to football, where the levelness of the playing field was so that even though you've got half time, you move from that end to that end. Generally speaking, you're kicking the ball along an even horizontal patch, and you have a referee. And as we know, there are offside rules and some disputed decisions, but you don't normally shoot the referee, but much as Everton supporters would normally think you ought to be able to. But anyway, we have now decided that there's a world where we can have free trade, it'll be hunky-dory, but no referee. Unless the implication is that we're happy to have a referee as long as he is not a foreigner, he or she is not a foreigner, or certainly as long as he's not a European foreigner, or as long as he's not specifically called the European Court of Justice. I mean, EFTA has a European Court of Arbitration. Is it just in a name? Or are people still irrational when it comes to how you have rules about trade and investment in Europe? And I would be very glad if the government would give a lead in making sure that their succession of white or green papers or whatever would be ruthlessly realistic in having a totally objective view about evaluating and publishing transparently how the national interest in terms of trade and investment and our world market share would match the different options on the table. And we had finally on yesterday's debate a very interesting vignette, I thought, which bears on all of this, which is about reciprocity. Yesterday's debate being the one about all of Brits living in Spain and all the Spanish, etc., 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 living here. And it began by being an acknowledgement that it was inherently a relationship of reciprocity, but we could give a lead by saying that we will make the first move and do it ourselves and so on. But the notion that we can have everything that suits us and, in a sense, ignore the fact there are 27 over there, or is it 26? I've forgotten. Anyway, them minus one are against our interests. All of them are simply wanting to recognise that the Brits want this particular interest to be reflected. But there has to be reciprocity. And we, of course, in this reciprocity, need reciprocal rules. And I don't think that simply to say that was not what people voted for, well, retrospectively, we can only deliver something which is deliverable, whatever people thought they were voting for, and I do not believe, to repeat, that they were voting in any conscious sense for, as I take this example, oh, we would like to have access to the single market but not be members of it. Well, my lords, I hope that the committee will go on and do further work, ruthlessly identifying the option and holding the government's feet to the fire to make sure that they do give us a running commentary. I don't buy this no running commentary, that we are parliamentarians and it's our job, not only ourselves, to have a running commentary, but to demand that the government engages with us in so doing.
My Lords, it is a privilege and a pleasure to serve on the European Union Internal Market Subcommittee under the able and affable chairmanship of the noble Lord, Lord Whitty, and the report we are debating today gave us the welcome opportunity to work in tandem with the EU External Affairs Subcommittee chaired by Baroness Verma. This proved both enlightening and somewhat daunting, and I am grateful to both chairs, as well as to the clerks and other staff, and of course to my committee colleagues and other noble lords speaking in this debate, for their contribution at least to the enlightenment part. The report provides an essentially factual analysis of available options, and its findings have already been outlined very clearly and succinctly by other noble lords. So I will try just to highlight some issues that strike me as significant. The government has made clear that its aim is to achieve an ambitious and comprehensive bespoke free trade agreement with the EU, together with a new customs agreement. And the Prime Minister has stated that no deal is better than a bad deal. So what would a good deal look like, my lords? What criteria will the government use to determine whether the outcome of the negotiations is good enough for the UK to sign up to it? I recently received a helpful document entitled A Successful Brexit, Four Economic Tests, from a body called the UK in a Changing Europe, based at King's College London. And this sets out a series of tests under four headings. Will Brexit make us better off economically? Will Brexit make Britain fairer? Will Brexit make the UK a more or less open economy and society? And will Brexit increase the democratic control of the British people over their own destiny? These tests make a lot of sense to me, but of course it is down to the government to determine the actual criteria to be used. So I would ask the noble lady, the minister, firstly, how does the government plan to define the criteria against which the merits of a deal will be assessed? Secondly, how will these criteria be tested to determine their acceptability to business and other affected interests, to Parliament, to the devolved nations, and of course to the electorate? Thirdly, what sort of process will the government conduct to evaluate the terms of a deal against the criteria and to explain the conclusions that they reach? And finally, what are the options being considered if a deal is found not to be acceptable against those criteria? My next point relates to the negotiating process and the engagement in it of business and other parties affected by the outcome. When I worked on trade issues for IBM in Washington in the early 1980s, in the lead-up to the GATT-Uruguay round, I was struck by the wide range of mechanisms used by the US administration to involve business and other groups in establishing negotiating objectives and priorities, and indeed to encourage such groups to do their own horse trading amongst themselves so as to present an agreed common position, often involving a considerable degree of compromise, to the US government. IBM had its own trade team and was an active member of organisations such as the American Electronics Association, the National Association of Manufacturers, the US Chamber of Commerce, and other bodies concerned with specific trade-related issues such as services or intellectual property or overseas investment. Its chairman and chief executive was one of a number of chief execs on a business roundtable task force which provided direct support to the US trade representative. To me, this points to a responsibility for both government and business in the UK to set up appropriate mechanisms to enable agreed common messages and objectives to be developed and fed into government and into the negotiations. What can the Minister tell us about plans to ensure the government does have access to clear, reliable, broadly agreed input and advice from business available at short notice if required? And it's, we've been encouraged, I think, that most of the businesses we have heard from in the committee have been positive about the level of engagement they have so far had with government and ministers. At the moment, of course, the government is mainly in listening mode, seeking to understand the range of issues raised by Brexit and how they affect businesses across the 50-plus sectors they are analysing. The real test will come, though, when they need to make trade-offs between different sectors and interests or determine priorities between competing options. My third point is about planning for situations that may arise in the course of the negotiating process, and I will address this by posing some what-if questions. What if, even with goodwill on both sides, a deal takes longer than 2 years to finalise? Given the challenge of reaching an ambitious and comprehensive bespoke FTA, and indeed in the light of the time needed to agree existing EU FTAs, such as that with Canada, the Committee felt that it would not be possible to complete a deal within 2 years, even though it may be easier to do so as an existing member already fully complying with EU rules and regulations than for a country outside the Union. But it is surely essential to have a Plan B in place. Article 50 does allow the possibility of extending the negotiating period beyond 2 years, but only if all 27 other member states agree. Can the noble lady, the minister, indicate what thought the government is giving to whether and how this might be achieved? What if a deal is in prospect but needs time to be brought fully into effect? Our report argues that a transitional agreement will almost certainly be necessary. So what thinking is the government doing about how such a transitional arrangement might work and what it might involve, such as a temporary continuation of the UK's membership of the EU Customs Union, which is indeed mentioned in the government's response to the report as a possibility? And other noble lords have raised the question of what the difference is between a transitional arrangement and a phased process of implementation. What if, at the end of the day, no deal proves possible because the various demands and interests of the other 27 countries prove irreconcilable with the goals of the UK? Do we just fall back on WTO rules, which in itself may not be wholly straightforward and is widely seen as highly undesirable? And a final what question, what can the Minister say about possible parameters for dispute resolution mechanisms? Enforcement is one of the strengths of the EU single market. Legal action can be taken, including by companies, even relatively small ones, and individuals, in their own national courts. And there are also other less costly mechanisms for resolving disputes, such as Solvit. None of the example dispute resolution mechanisms in the annex to the Brexit White Paper comes close to matching the EU arrangements. And indeed, one possibility that perhaps for obvious reasons is not mentioned at all is whether the EU Court of Justice might have a role to play in a new bespoke dispute resolution system, without, of course, having primacy over a counterpart UK court or panel. In conclusion, my lords, this report raises some crucial issues for the conduct of the Brexit strategy and negotiations. I don't for a moment expect all the answers from the noble lady, the minister, today, but I do believe that the government will need to share considerably more of its thinking on such issues than it has been willing to do to date, if it is to end up with an outcome that is clearly recognised as a good deal, that reflects the needs of business and other interests in a balanced way, and that is achievable in the time available even if that time has to be extended beyond 2 years. I hope the Minister can give us some reassurance about how the Government plans to tackle this challenge and how optimism, as another noble lord suggested, could be matched by realism.
My Lord, the findings of this excellent report are in the document before the House. Having listened to the evidence of companies on the cutting edge of our economy, I wanted to take this opportunity to talk about what our future as a country might need to look like if we are to trade post the decision of the 23rd of June last year in a changing world, to truly optimise the development of products and services that we can sell not just to Europe but across the world. My Lords, sitting on House committees sometimes feels for me a little schizophrenic, because I am conscious that as a working peer I live my life nowadays in two very different worlds which gloriously collide in this place. This, of course, is one of the reasons why the House of Lords is such a treasure and needs to be preserved at all costs in a modern economy. But it can also be a little painful when you find yourselves riding two horses at the same time. I have spent most of my working life growing and developing modern entrepreneurial environments that generate innovation, both in public services and in wider products and services that do not sit neatly in traditional government silos. I am an innovator by nature and know that new ideas and ways of working do not come out of the clouds, but develop when very different skills and experiences collide. New products and services in the modern world will now come from between the siloed worlds of government and business, not from within them. In this internet age, this is increasingly so. We have heard in the evidence that sits behind this report that modern digital entrepreneurial environments that generate these new products and services that we must now sell across the world come about through networks of individuals engaging together across different disciplines from clusters where different skills and businesses sit cheek by jowl. The modern entrepreneurial environment is not about policies, strategies and reports so favoured by civil servants. It is all about people and relationships and learning through hands-on experience. This traditional government environment increasingly is no longer fit for purpose in a very fast-moving business environment within which SMEs certainly now live, a rapidly expanding sector of our economy. This is as true here as it is for our partners across Europe. My Lords, I am responsible today for the development of 10 entrepreneurial campuses in 10 towns and cities in the north of England based on 33 years of work in East London, and I declare my interests. My 10 clusters in the north are bringing together very entrepreneurial business people, business leaders, leaders in the public sector, local residents and emerging businesses and social entrepreneurs. They are generating lateral out-of-the-box relationships, and it is fascinating to watch the speed with which these organisms are growing if the conditions are right. In time, I can see already lots of opportunities for new cross-cutting products and services that we could export across the world if these young flowers are watered and given time to blossom. Brexit is a real opportunity for new thinking about the opportunities now presenting themselves in a digitised world which exist outside traditional silos. To grasp it, we all need a real change of mindset, both in Europe and in this country, if we are to trade with the world. We have, my Lords, I suspect, more in common than we realise. The clues in this new world are in the micro, not the macro. They are not necessarily in large corporate businesses and institutions. Small is beautiful in this new world. Last week, a former finance director of one of our most established banks came to see me, a young man who had decided to resign from the security of his position. Why? Because he was fed up with the outdated politics that went with the job, the endless treacle and bureaucracy he had to drown in. He wanted a more fulfilling life. He wanted to innovate in financial services. He wanted to use his many skills and knowledge to rethink the industry. He now has a £50 million fund, and within 1 hour, with no forms and papers, we were agreeing practical work we could start to do together on the back of a handshake. Another of our very large government-controlled banks that I have been dealing with recently, who will remain nameless, have forced me into endless meetings in silos and red tape with no joined-up thinking. The middle management and those at the front edge of this bank were great. They wanted freeing up to engage with me and my colleagues. Those sitting in the boardroom were apparently unaware and uninterested in all this entrepreneurial behaviour below them. It didn't fit in with their policies. I worry that the bank will be out of business in 20 years' time if it doesn't focus more on this entrepreneurial activity at the leading edge of the business. This bank felt more siloed and bureaucratic than anything I've experienced in our universities or the NHS, and that is saying something. 2 weeks ago, I attended an NHS awards ceremony in Liverpool, which was celebrating new health products and services being generated by some of our finest minds. We saw great examples of products and innovations that are being generated out of the real-life experience of our northern hospitals. But when you dug below the surface, you could hear the frustration of a young generation of entrepreneurs and innovators in our health world, who were swimming through treacle with their hands tied behind their backs. We are asking them to dance with lead weights on their shoulders. There was a sense of despair and resignation about the NHS culture, also from senior managers present who were looking forward to retirement. I was reading recently in the Financial Times that in the city, a lot of business analysts are losing their jobs because it has finally dawned on people that no one was actually reading the reports they produced. The emperor has no clothes. Instead, businesses are developing real-time dashboards to give them information about what is happening to their businesses right now, not 3 or 12 months ago. I found myself wondering if central government, local authorities, or NHS trusts might take this approach, and we might develop some world-beating technology to sell around the world. I'm not exactly holding out hope, because it is rare to find in the statutory sector examples of real learning organisations. Sadly, I feel that may be true also for some large businesses and some charities, and may also be true a lot in Europe. But unless we can make this sort of change, what will our world standing be in the post-Brexit world? One of the assumptions that I find fascinating the whole Brexit debate is the idea that British bureaucracy and rule from Westminster rather than Brussels is inherently or automatically going to be more imaginative, more responsive, more forward-looking, as suggested by these examples. If we don't manage this, I fear future generations will scratch their heads as to why people thought Brexit would lead to real and positive change. My Lords, I'm sorry that sometimes at our meetings I sound a little crusty and difficult. I'm only trying to ensure the voices and experiences of this next generation of entrepreneurs and innovators that I have described is heard and experienced. Our future economy and trade post-Brexit depends upon them. My Lords, the noble Lord, Lord Howell, is reminding us that the Great Repeal Bill is a real opportunity to help them get hold of our regulatory and bureaucratic world and bend it in favour of this new generation for the real reasons Lord Green has just articulated to us. I think Lord Howell is right. An opportunity to remove lots of treacle and create more flexibility to boost our trade, products and services. But has anyone seen this important opportunity marching up this new robe? Maybe we should look at this, Lord Whitty, at our committee. Maybe we should try and get into a different kind of conversation about this new emerging entrepreneurial world focused on innovation that affects both us and our partners in Europe. It affects all our trading and will do into the future. My Lords, I suspect we have more in common in this new trading world than we may think as we negotiate a new trade treaty. Maybe we need all of us in this country and in Europe to start to think a little more outside the box.
My Lords, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to contribute. I will attempt to be as brief as I possibly can. I'm helped not least by the fact that our two chairs introduced the debate and distilled the report with such clarity. And I'm also further helped by my noble friends, not least Lord Gadier and Lord Green of Hurst Pierpoint, who
respectively, I think, in a brilliant forensic fashion, talked about both the substance of the negotiations and the issues there, and indeed some of the challenges more broadly for the United Kingdom in achieving the success in global free trade. It's not enough simply to open markets, one has to win in markets. But I want to therefore just to follow, if I may, something that my noble friend Baroness Verma was referring to, and talk about one issue, and that is the question of the future customs arrangement. Because it did seem to me, when I heard, of course, after our report, and we had talked about the customs union, I remember when we were meeting at one point preparing the report, we said, we know one of the first issues that the government is going to have to decide is whether it is in the customs union or out of the customs union. And indeed, they have decided out of the customs union. When the Prime Minister made her 17th of January speech, and she said, we're out of the customs union because we can't agree with the common commercial policy and we can't agree with a common external tariff. I think I may not have been alone in wondering what that customs arrangement for the future necessarily therefore looks like. My noble friend Lord Bridges on Monday evening touched upon this and talked about the possibilities, for example, how US and Canada are able to achieve sophisticated supply chain activity across borders where they don't have a customs union. He also, of course, reminded us, which ministers have rightly done, that the digitalisation of documentation for customs purposes has proceeded apace, not least in the last decade. And I think probably the United Kingdom is best in class where customs documentation by digital means is concerned. And he said, 99% of customs declarations are received electronically here and 96% are cleared in seconds. He also interestingly referred to authorised economic operator status and said 60% of UK imports and 74% of UK exports are accounted for by UK companies with AEO status. So we're starting to see a bit, therefore, of what the government might have in mind by what frictionless trade across borders looked like. Of course, the central prior issue is achieving a zero tariff relationship with the European Union. But let me for the moment say that clearly is part of the negotiations, but let's assume that that can be achieved. It may not be, but if it isn't, then there are serious inherent problems that emerge from that. But leaving that on one side, the customs relationship, nonetheless, the border relationship, nonetheless, has some pretty serious issues that we have to deal with. There is reconciling all of this transfer of data electronically with the physical transfer of goods. There is the business of understanding how rules of origin are going to apply to in the supply chain and of certification in order to comply with that. There is the business of dealing with, for example, anti-dumping. I remember many years ago, over 40 years ago nearly, I was responsible for the generalised scheme of preferences for chemicals in the Department of Trade and Industry, as then was. If we are going to align ourselves with the European Union long term, they are, I think, going to be looking for us to have a generalised scheme of preferences and things like anti-dumping arrangements, which do not allow, as indeed I think is generally going to be the case, for any external aspect of their tariff, be it anti-dumping, be it tariff impositions, be it quantitative restrictions, to be circumvented by those who are able to bring their goods into the United Kingdom and re-export them to the rest of the EU. So we can see this whole string of potential difficulties, which could, of course, lead to cost, to delay, to relative lack of competitiveness and to bottlenecks at borders. But I think at the same time, I just want to really ask ministers if they will do one thing for me, which is that they will tell us more about what the possibilities are for dealing with this and involve us directly in thinking about this. It's not part of the negotiations. I don't think it prejudices the negotiations in any respect for us to be working hard now to try and put in place the practical mechanisms for facilitating trade and reducing the costs and delay involved in trade across borders for the longer term. We are going to have a customs bill, a piece of customs legislation. We should, in my view, have an opportunity to have the government come forward with its proposals at an early and draft stage, a pre-legislative scrutiny, follow up with the External Affairs Committee's report with this pre-legislative scrutiny in order to get the bill right and have it a better chance of having our legal framework as well as our administrative framework in place before the 2 years or a further transitional period is completed. What does it look like? We know the customs declaration system at the moment, so-called chief, customs handling for import and export freight, has about 90 million transactions. After Brexit, it could rise fourfold. There is going to be a new customs declaration system, as it happens, in 2019. It has to be a project that is configured and capable for handling that dramatic increase in the potential complexity and number of those customs declarations. The authorised economic operators, I think there are only a few hundred of those in this country, because to get there, to be an AEO, is costly and difficult. We need some additional mechanism by which small and medium-sized enterprises can themselves acquire some of the trusted status which goes along with that, both for security and indeed for customs simplification purposes, so that they can access the same kind of cross-border mechanisms. There is technology which allows us to track vehicles, track goods, track shipments in ways that mean we don't necessarily have to stop people at borders. And insofar as they are stopped at borders, it will be on a risk basis, a risk-based assessment, not on the basis of long queues with everybody having to be checked through. And not least, I will say, as a some 30 years ago, a former Deputy Director General of the British Chambers of Commerce, all over the world, the Chambers of Commerce helped to make this trade work. In this country, we have chambers who have a long history of certification of origin and of trade facilitation. We have hundreds of trade facilitation experts, they're not international trade negotiators, but trade facilitation experts in chambers of commerce. We need in the future to have new customs arrangements, but an opportunity also through designing a UK customs code to replace the Union Customs Code, the opportunity to improve the circumstances for businesses in this country, reduce the cost of compliance, and make our trade easier for small businesses in particular. And I would urge ministers perhaps to work with us in the way I've described, but also to work with my friends in the Chamber of Commerce movement to try and put that kind of trade facilitation in place for small businesses for the future.
My Lords, I rise somewhat hesitantly and hopefully briefly to add to what I think has been a remarkable cross-party consensus of gloom and apprehension about the prospects for a successful outcome of the government's wish to conclude an ambitious and comprehensive trade agreement with our, well, we're no longer allowed to call them partners. I noticed Lord Bridges yesterday was calling them counterparts. It's an interesting shift from partners to counterparts. But I think our chances of concluding this agreement successfully are not very good. It's been a privilege to serve on the committee that produced this report. I think it provides a very balanced assessment. I've personally learnt a lot. There's a sort of trade on the fact that I know a bit about Europe. Well, I certainly learnt an awful lot in the process of these hearings. And I think it's an excellent report, which we owe, of course, an awful lot to the clerks and our officers and our witnesses. An excellent report, and very ably chaired, in my case, by Lord Whitty on the Internal Market Committee, to whom I'm very grateful. But I think what is true of the report is that its balanced assessment contrasts with the kind of bluster and assertion of the government's position, and I find that worrying. Where's the government getting it wrong? I think that the starting point is the self-deluding proposition that we're in a very strong and good position in these negotiations. I don't think we are. One of the comments that to justify this confidence is made in the response to our report, in the response to recommendation 18, where they say, the government says, we're starting from a very different position to other countries looking to agree free trade agreements with the EU, because unlike most negotiations, these talks will not be about bringing two divergent systems together, but about managing the continued cooperation of the UK and the EU. And we're confident that it's in everyone's interests to arrive at a mutually beneficial deal. Well, I think that's false optimism, I'm afraid. Because if you think about it, well, maybe the rules are at present the same because we're all members of the EU as it is. But are they automatically in future going to stay the same? And are we committing to keep our rules in line with European rules in order to have access to those markets? And when I look at another bit of what the government says in its response to our report, it says, equivalence will of course be an important part of any discussion on our future trading relationship, but we are committed to taking control of our own laws as the people of the United Kingdom have demanded we must. So, is the government going to seek to maintain equivalence in the future, or is it going to exercise sovereignty in determining its own rules affecting our trading position? I mean, a very obvious example of this, for it is coming up right now. The key sector of automobiles, very, very important in terms of our manufactured exports, we're clearly going to have to devise a lot of rules to deal with the coming of the autonomous vehicle. That's happening in the next 10 years. Are we going to follow the Brussels rules in order to guarantee access for our manufacturers, or are we going to have a completely independent approach and say, we have a right to determine our own rules on safety and everything else, in which case we'll create tremendous trade problems for ourselves. And I don't think that the government is giving a clear answer on that at all. So that's the problem. Another problem is that I don't think that the negotiating position we're in is a very strong one. We have much more to lose from a breakdown of these talks than does the EU27. Our trade with the EU is a much higher proportion of our GDP than it is of the EU27's. And I don't think the government seems to understand that point. And the timetable that the government has set itself, without willingness to contemplate a proper transition phase, is truly frightening. Because you're not actually talking about 2 years. As I see it, in practice, you're talking about the period from the end of the negotiations for the new German coalition, which is when you'll have a German government that's able to make political compromises, which will probably be in November, December this year, until next, the autumn of the following year, when the draft agreements would have to start being put to the European Parliament if they're going to be agreed by March 2019. This is a frighteningly short timetable for issues which are of huge complexity. And if the talks break down, the cost to us is going to be enormous. And there are some sectors where we don't even have the WTO to fall back on. We heard about that yesterday in the Article 50 debates on Euratom. Nuclear industry is supposed to be one of our strategic ambitions in our industrial strategy white paper. Yet, if we don't reach agreement with the EU, Euratom comes to an end, and there can be no transport of nuclear fuels with other countries or nuclear materials because there's no regulatory regime to cover them. And the same is true of aviation, the same is true of broadcasting. I mean, there is a terrible cliff edge for a lot of key sectors of the British economy. I think if I just, you know, if it wasn't so tragic, I would laugh. It's a bit like someone who after 44 years has been a member of the golf club and decides, oh no, I'm not going to be a member anymore, but I still want to play on the course every day. However, I'm not prepared to pay a membership fee for this privilege. I want to determine rules of my own as to who works on this course, because I'm not having your free movement rules. And I also claim the right to rewrite the rules whatever it suits me, because I insist that I have the national sovereignty to do so. Well, this is ludicrous. I mean, this is not a sensible way of behaving. If you're going to leave a club but you want to stay in it, you've got to make lots of adjustments to make that possible. I hope this whole experience doesn't turn out badly, but I fear it is, and I fear for the country.
Yeah. Lords, it is always worthwhile listening to the noble lord, and may I say, I think the noble lord asked one or two very, very pertinent points, a question about the future of the situation of our mutual relationship. But first of all, it really gives me great pleasure to thank the noble lord Whitty for introducing this debate so well, for chairing the proceedings on his committee, but of course most particularly I want to thank the noble Baroness Lady Verma, who also made such a very good contribution and chaired our proceedings so well. And I'd also like to add my appreciation to the staff, who really did such a brilliant job in pulling this all together. They really are the unsung heroes of the situation. Now, the report, since its publication has been indicated, we now have a much clearer view of government intent, but the pursuit of the free trade agreement, details of which are certainly not yet at hand. And this is our dilemma in our discussion this evening. But the possibility also exists, as we've discussed, of our just having to deal with the WTO if the whole process fails. And indeed, we do not know very much more than that at this point. But what I would therefore like to do is focus on some elements of the topography of trade post our formal departure, including, of course, non-tariff barriers. And whilst we, of course, initially will be incorporating EU legislation into our own legislation, the challenge thereafter is how we manage the inevitable regulatory and other changes as the EU itself evolves. Now, as we've often heard, supply chains are uppermost in businesses' minds. We could, in theory, see tariffs levied at different production levels across borders with several times, with all the difficulties that brings. And whilst there appears to be a template offered by NAFTA, particularly between the USA and Canada, with simplified customs procedures, the issue of a pan-European supply chain is a huge, significant factor to manufacturers, most notably in the successful automotive sector. Both the supply chain and regulations on quality assurance are fundamentally important as we seek a new trade agreement, not only with the EU and others. We naturally would favour preferential rules of origin. Rules of origin apply currently, But I wonder if my noble friend the Minister could try to expand further on how possible preferential rates of origin might apply as we leave the currently structured customs union, as presumably there would still be an issue of more burdensome administrative checks to be undertaken. Now, regrettably, the UK traditionally suffers a considerable trade deficit. What is left of our manufacturing is modern, productive, and in many instances a great success story, for example, the car industry. However, it is mostly foreign-owned. So what every government has had to do for decades is continuously seek to attract foreign direct investment to fill the trade balance void. And successive UK governments have sought to minimise any disincentives to the purchase of British assets, and broadly this has been a success. And we have traditionally remained the single most favoured European investment destination. But of course, as we've heard, access to the single market is at least a substantial part of the reason why this investment comes in the first place. Not only to avoid tariff disincentives, but potential non-tariff barriers as well. So concluding an FDA is, for all the reasons so perfectly and thoughtfully put by your lordships this evening, is something which is absolutely crucial for our continuing survival. Now, of course, our report relates to the EU, but there is an impact not only on the EU, but of course on other markets which we need to address. For example, in two key markets, but in particular Japan and China, the demand for high standards is increasingly marked. Now, we're signed up to the EU, that's one thing, and that's at present. But a common EU-wide regulatory system is both efficacious and avoids high administration costs. If we take the pharmaceutical industry, our pharmaceutical companies, which is bound to be put under a spotlight during these negotiations, often ultimately owned by non-British enterprises, as well as food and beverage suppliers, this is going to be tested. And whilst we may start with the assurance that common regulation and standards provide, our export destination countries need to understand how our regulatory and therefore quality system will prevail post-Brexit. And whilst we know that the EU-Korea and EU-Switzerland agreements provide useful templates for mutual recognition and certification, this is going to be an increasing challenge as living standards improve in our key export markets as we seek to create new business agreements with those countries which enjoy a trade agreement with the EU at present. My Lords, in a recent speech, my noble friend Lord Hill reminded us that there are 27 other countries now directly or indirectly engaged in our negotiation process, with all the potential pitfalls, as we saw in the Wallonia problem in the EU-Canada agreement. But it is interesting to note, and this is on a rather more optimistic note, that the European Commission has just published a working paper on equivalence in financial services, which at least accepts the need for compliance and international standards in tax and money laundering, as well as potential reciprocal trading rights with third countries. This is incredibly important for our financial services industry. And as I hope this form, this sort of realism will prevail during our direct negotiations with the European Commission over the broad range of goods and services. Rather than what my noble friend Lord Horam described as a fist to the face. So it goes without saying, and may I just emphasize this, in the language we deploy, a prosperous EU is totally and completely in our own national interest, and we have to go on saying that. Now, my noble friend Lady Verma, mentioned the complexities, for example, of the agricultural sector in negotiations. So may I ask my lords for some sort of forbearance in mentioning one rather personal instance as to how really deep our current agreements reach within the EU. I'd like to declare an interest as the government appointed director of the Horse Race Betting Levy Board and as a former Member of Parliament for Newmarket. Freedom of movement implies usually human beings, but I want to bring an equine dimension into this discussion. A tripartite agreement between the UK, France and Ireland currently allows thoroughbred horses to travel freely between the three countries for race meetings. Under an EU directive, horses only need to have a simple passport arrangement, no customs documentation or a veterinary export health certificate. I can only hope that a frictionless trade agreement will be extended to this valued part of British life. But it simply illustrates how far we are embedded in the totality of EU architecture. So I hope that the next 2 years will bear fruit. It will be a challenge. May I penultimately make a plea to my noble friend the Minister to communicate this as appropriate. It is certainly gratifying, as we have heard, that there are skilled individuals now being deployed in our negotiations to forge new trade relationships and that with the EU. But may I highlight how, with some notable exceptions, our embassies are under-resourced and insufficiently manned compared with our soon-to-be rival neighbours. As one of the Prime Minister's trade envoys, I see how active EU countries, particularly currently, because they sense an opportunity, are in a number of promising export destinations hard at work. It is a matter of the utmost concern to me and others that while some embassies have liberal funds specifically for social or political projects, their ability to promote trade is wholly inadequate. If our embassies are to be part of developing our post-Brexit strategy, as promised, the ludicrous resources available to them needs to be dealt with the utmost speed. And any other trade envoy would tell your lordships exactly the same thing. We can only hope that a free trade agreement can be secured to avoid the additional burden which WTO tariffs imply. How necessary it could well be to secure some transitional arrangements we all accept to give assurance to those foreign investors and businesses which are so important to our national economic life, survival and prosperity.
I'll start by expressing my thanks to the chairs of both committees and to the staff who produced this excellent report with us, and indeed to the witnesses who prepared so carefully for evidence sessions. Now, this has been an excellent debate, and I have found myself in agreement with almost everything that has been said so eloquently on all sides of this House. This whole process of preparing for Brexit, I find infinitely depressing. Thursday mornings are a very depressing part of the week, despite the excellent company of my fellow committee members, because one witness after another, experts, practitioners, trade bodies, and so on, parade before us the complexities of the situation we are in. Such warnings are all around us. Last night, the president of the CBI talked about his fears of the whole process, calling it a roller coaster and warning that no deal with the EU would hit 90% of our exports to the EU, either in tariffs or non-tariff barriers. It is a great pity, I believe, my lords, that none of the strongest opponents to the EU in this House are here this evening to hear the variety and depth of this debate. The government's very late response to our report also makes a depressing read. Either the government has very few words in its lexicon, as envisaged by my noble friend, or it has very few ideas, because the same banal, generalised, high-level statements are repeated over and over again. Ambitious and comprehensive, frictionless, no cliff edge, and so on. The endless repetition was so intense that I felt, by the end of reading that response, that I was being brainwashed. As with the white paper, I was also distressed by the apparent smug self-confidence of the government. I have referred to this as hubris before. I believe the use of the term world-class and world-leading show the overconfidence. Now, there is, however, a new line which does appear in the government's response to this report, and that is that it will be all right because we are already well integrated with the EU. We currently have no trade barriers, so apparently we are unlikely to have any in the future. Now, if the government seriously believes this, then they have been deaf to the statements coming from our current EU partners. They have said, in terms, if you leave the club and cease to pay the membership fee and no longer agree to play by the rules, then you can no longer enjoy the benefits of membership. And we have already announced not just that we want to leave the club, but we don't even want associate membership. Now, I think that in reality, like ducks on the lake, the government is paddling furiously just below the waterline. Indeed, the list of meetings, the impressive list of meetings in this government response that they have held with business organisations and the hundreds of additional civil servants they've recruited are signs of the effort and work going on. I just reflect that it's such a pity that those extra civil servants are needed in order for us just to fight to stay still. I would have preferred them to be doing something rather more creative. What I looked for in the government response was some acknowledgement of the sheer complexity of the situation. And the committee report we're discussing today makes that complexity plain. Albeit, this is only an introductory taster to the true difficulties. This morning, our committee discussed its next report, which looks behind and beyond the level of detail in the report we're discussing here, to a whole further level of complexity. And I believe it should be compulsory for everyone who tells us it's all quite straightforward to read not just the summary of this report today, but the actual body of the report. It's only by reading the body of the report that you understand the complexity. Doesn't need to be this report, perhaps. It could be any one of the excellent reports that have been produced by our EU committees. They are authoritative and comprehensive, but as I've said before, also depressing. You know, in my inbox and on Twitter, there are two categories of pro-Brexit campaigners. And just for clarity, I don't put everyone pro-Brexit in these two categories, but I want to refer to two types of response. They are what I call Brexit bullies, who feel that by shouting loudly and heaping sometimes personal insults on those who oppose Brexit, that they will drown out the arguments being put before them. And there are the lemmings, those who are blindly following their leaders towards the government's famous cliff edge. This report and others in the series should be read by all lemmings, because it sets in context, in factual, precise detail, the enormous, complex task that the government faces. And I want briefly to refer to a couple of detailed issues. Our report refers to political costs and potential costs and delays associated with more complex border and customs processes. The government's response that this is all done electronically now. And that's been put forward in the Northern Ireland, Republic of Ireland context, and I very much hope that it could be a contribution, although I believe that should not be overestimated in its potential. But in general terms, the value of electronic processes needs to be considered. And I draw attention of your lordships to an article in this week's Times about the considerable delays at the Turkish-Bulgarian border, up to 30 hours, and reference is made to bulky sheets of documents. Now, Turkey is in a customs union with the EU, and the point made in the article is that EU states can and do impose significant transit fees and permits based on a quota system. And each EU country sets its own fees. That is despite the customs union. Now, the Road Haulage Association has warned of the need for significant investment in infrastructure of ports and customs. We have very little as of such infrastructure because we haven't needed it for 40 years. They warn of the total lack of experience and knowledge in the road haulage industry on these matters. So my question to the Minister is, can she tell us what precisely the government is doing to prepare for this? Dispute resolution procedures. Our report refers to the advantages of the EU system and the disadvantages of the WTO system. And I believe that we need to ask ourselves, why would the EU agree, as the government suggests in its response, to a separate and new system that the government hopes to set up with the EU, when one already exists from their perspective? Any new system that is established has to be accessible to small businesses and just as accessible as the current system. The government's response, beyond the Prime Minister's statement that we would not remain within the single market or the EEA, has not got very much detail. In debate earlier this week, one noble lord, when we were referring to negotiating and revealing our hand, compared our negotiations with those with the IRA and the DUP in Northern Ireland. I wanted to examine that. Negotiations in Northern Ireland were between groups who had been seeking to kill each other. We are talking about negotiating with our EU partners and friends who've sat on the same side of the table with us for 40 years. That I think that the government places too much emphasis on keeping its powder dry, keeping its hand close to its chest, its cards close to its chest. Those other countries who've been our friends for 40 years know every nook and cranny of what we are trying to negotiate and what we want to do. My lords, these days, there is global interdependence. If we want to trade, we effectively have to pool sovereignty with others. The irony is that because the EU is the world's biggest customs union, it dictates much of the terms and standards of world trade. And we will have to accept that, whatever the government leads us to in terms of negotiations on Brexit.
My lords, there's an abbreviation that expresses the sense that someone feels that they weren't at the right place at the right time, and something else rather remarkable went on. It's called FOMO, the fear of missing out. Well, my lords, I fear I have a case of FOMO when it comes to looking at this committee's report. This has been an excellent and extraordinary debate, with eloquence, relevance and expertise in every contribution. We owe a great debt to the Internal Market and External Affairs subcommittees, and in particular to the noble Baroness, Baroness Verma, and to my noble friend Lord Whitty for the excellent way that they have brought its conclusions to life and brought the committee together. I do note that there is, of course, a further report on what a good deal in trade and services will look like, and I do hope that we get a very early opportunity to debate that in the House. Now, whilst
events have moved on, the report still, in my view, stands the test of time. In short, this report and debate demonstrates that whilst an approach, that of pursuing a free trade agreement, has been chosen, there are many other elements at play which cause uncertainties and complexity. Official trade statistics show that the European Union is the destination for about half of all British goods and exports. But the trading links are bigger if we include the countries we trade freely with, as they have a free trade agreement with the European Union. These agreements mean that 63% of Britain's goods and exports are linked to EU membership. So what's at stake here is about more than just the single market. It's about how entwined and how much and more impactful the last decades of economic connections and their evolution, and those elements will rest very heavily on the construction of an even more complex series of future arrangements. This report is full of sound advice, and it is a report which should be reread constantly throughout the process of negotiations and as people consider our options. Well, as I'd like to touch on three themes from the report, and I think three themes from this debate. The first is one of synchronicity. The task of doing the withdrawal from the EU, establishing what the free trade agreement will look like, preparing trade agreements with other countries and other sorts of elements, with all the problems of whether or not we can have those in sequential or concurrent mechanisms, how interrelated those elements are, whether or not they're determined by a lot of economics or a little bit more politics. All of that will shape a very difficult series of considerations. And the government will need to consider what is fundamental and what anchors we need. And there is a big question about what assumptions the government makes about how to integrate into any track or discussions a whole variety of other elements which fall from the side, and some of which we haven't touched on in detail during the debate, but have been touched on in the report. Questions around the UK's position in WTO schedules and our share of EU quotas. In tandem with these discussions, we need to design and agree future trade relations with the least developed countries and other developing countries which are currently covered by the EU's generalised system of preferences. In practical terms, how and when this is done will be crucial for our export position in developing markets, and our EU competitors will take advantage of any interregnum that we create as a result. My Lords, to ease negotiations with third countries, joining existing or intended large regional or mega-regional agreements could be advantageous. However, doing so may also result in a loss of sovereignty and raise other issues relating to migration and financial contribution. What view does the government make about whether or not this is something that they will consider in the tapestry of new trade relationships? Secondly, we have a large question of capacity. The report raises the issue of capacity, and I have heard the views of others that they are reassured that we're at least starting to make some progress on this. I have to say I am less reassured. My own experience of the government's dealings with other sectors is that we have created, for presentational purposes, not always a bad thing, but for presentational purposes, layers which don't inherently indicate that we are going to take some of these considerations of companies and businesses and the long list covered in the government's reply in the mechanism that will add to the capacity of our country to deal with the huge challenge. We are faced with the task of negotiating more than 100 new trade agreements if we leave the EU Customs Union. In addition, trade partners in regional and bilateral agreements may want to change the terms of their existing agreements. The most immediate challenge the UK faces arises from our lack of and reduced negotiating power as a sole actor, time pressures and concerns about how the character of negotiations will be conducted. In view of the narrow base of domestic expertise in conducting trade negotiations, we will need to recruit and train a large body of new specialist staff. Now, we will also, and I think this is a very important point, need to re-engineer how we do negotiations, how we do trade, and how we recreate the Whitehall machine to adequately deal with how policy has to be addressed across a variety of departments. But crucially, and this was raised by other noble lords, there are questions about what support and advice has been given to British businesses. If the UK is to expose its markets to greater competition, we also need to make sure we're ready to help potentially disadvantaged groups at home to adjust. We have to get these elements right. It's not just our capacity to negotiate, it's our capacity to deal with the consequences of the negotiations and the pattern of the negotiations. Thirdly, the question of data. As the Noble Lord Whitty said, no comprehensive economic evaluations have been made. And these are absolutely crucial. Making a correct estimate of our trade interests, as well as properly informing the slowly developing industrial strategy, requires us to have a very sophisticated view of the dynamics in our economy and in the existing trade situation, as well as a correct estimate of the trade opportunities and context of other markets. This is no small challenge. To illustrate the point, let's look at services. A large volume of services are being traded across borders directly. For instance, a legal opinion or a form of insurance. This area is relatively easy to quantify. But a large amount of our services are wrapped up in other activities. Some services trade camouflages as merchandise trades, as they encompass service inputs. For example, elements which are value added in the context of design or about some forms of advice, research and development. How the data traces how value is added in both goods and services along the supply chain has only just started to emerge and is not particularly meaningful at this stage. And the strength of the services available, the quantity, quality and availability and geography play an ever more important role in making manufacturing competitive. Understanding how these impact and how we can design the right sort of policies and the future architecture of what our trade relations should be with Europe and all the other countries that we're looking at will require a much better set of data than we have at the moment. So I would be very keen to know, in relation to that question about comprehensive economic analysis, what sort of work the government does plan to do on that. It also, in my view, does touch on the issue of capacity. Many of the officials who we are training now to look at some of the aspects of trade were some of the officials who had great expertise in a variety of areas, whose knowledge we now need to enhance the ability for those areas to be adequately covered in the negotiations, and they are now focusing on different elements. And I think it shows a sense in which the breadth of the people, the breadth of the experience that's going to be required, and expertise will play an ever-increasing part during these negotiations and discussions. My Lords, what this debate has shown are the complexities of negotiations and our position. The path we are on is not the one that I wanted, but our task is to make the best of this situation. As someone who comes from a business background, I'm hot-wired to think about what's the best that we can do. But the government's challenge is to face up to the need for a realistic approach and to prepare for the ripples and waves caused by the negotiations, which will wash over all sorts of different areas of our economy and our country. And without addressing it adequately, there are too many questions and uncertainties. And uncertainty is the main destroyer of GDP and our greatest economic risk in the short and medium term. My Lords, whilst the government needs to provide leadership and has the responsibility to conduct the withdrawal from the EU, the political need to look in control and to ignore building a broader capacity for our countries to succeed in the face of this challenge is self-defeating. This report and the EU committees demonstrate that there are others who can make a valuable contribution, and the government will do well to reach out more to them.
Thank you.
My Lords, I'm very grateful to the Noble Lord Whitty for calling this debate and for his excellent speech. I'd also like to thank the EU Internal Market Subcommittee and the EU External Affairs Subcommittee for its report, Brexit, the Options for Trade. The report provides a rigorous analysis of how the government might approach a new trading relationship with the European Union, and the committee will now have received the government's response to its report. As you will know, Lord Price appeared with Lord Bridges before the committee in October last year and again last month to discuss the upcoming publications Brexit Future Trade between the UK and EU in Services and Brexit Future Trade between the UK and EU in Goods. I'm looking forward to the contents of this report. of these two reports, which have been informed by evidence from key sectors as diverse as pharmaceuticals, food and automotive. As a businesswoman and former chairman of CBI Scotland, I know that during times of change, trading continuity is vital. That is also why the government has held thousands of visits, meetings and events with businesses since the referendum. Lord Price alone has met with over 50 ministers from foreign governments since the referendum, 18 of whom are in the EU. And the reason he is unable to attend this debate today is that he's on his way to attend the informal Trade Foreign Affairs Council in Malta. And can I just take this opportunity to pay tribute to my noble friend Lord Price for the work that he's undertaking and also to wish him a happy birthday. In addition, ministers from the Department for Exiting the European Union have met with more than 150 businesses through roundtable meetings with key sectors. My Lords, I'm very pleased to be able to wind up for the government in this debate and will now look to address the points that have been raised. I will also look to set out the government's plans going forward. Since the publication of this report, the Prime Minister has of course, set out the government's plan for Britain, including the 12 principles which will guide the government during negotiations surrounding the UK's withdrawal from the European Union. The government has also published a white paper on the UK's exit from a new partnership with the EU. In response to the points raised by some noble lords on the government's narrative on these issues, our strength is speaking with one voice. Speaking with one consistent voice is, in fact, a negotiating strength. As the Prime Minister has said, we will not be seeking membership of the single market, but will pursue instead a new strategic partnership with the EU, including an ambitious and comprehensive free trade agreement. We want the UK to be able to negotiate its own trade agreements. We want our new relationship with the EU to aim for the freest possible trade in goods and services, and for cross-border trade to be as frictionless as possible. I thank my noble friend Baroness Verma for her question on customs agreement with the EU, and would say that we are seeking a new customs agreement with the EU. There are a number of options for any new customs arrangements, including a completely new agreement for the UK to retain some elements of the existing arrangements. The precise form of this new agreement will be subject to negotiation. May I remind noble lords that we start from a unique position. On day one, we will have exactly the same regulations and standards as our negotiating partners. This provides an unprecedented starting point for our negotiations with the EU. We will aim to have reached an agreement about our future partnership by the time the two-year Article 50 process has concluded. Article 50 states that the process of withdrawal will take account of the framework of the leaving member states' future relationship with the EU, and there is a clear connection between the terms of our withdrawal and the future relationship we want to establish. As we've said before, it is in no one's interest for there to be a cliff edge for business as we change from our existing relationship to a new partnership with the European Union. That is why the government has announced that we will establish the UK's independent position at the WTO, of which the UK is a full and founding member. We are currently represented by the EU at the WTO, but as a post-EU member, we will need to separate out our schedules of commitments, which are currently integrated into the schedule for the EU as a whole. We will do this in a way which causes the least disruption possible to our trading partners. Addressing the concern raised by my noble friend Baroness Verma around the UK's technical rectification of WTO schedules, as the WTO Director General Roberto Azevedo stated in support of the UK's position, the UK is a member of the WTO today. It will continue to be a member tomorrow. There will be no continuity in membership. My Lords, our ambition is clear. We want Britain to become a champion of free trade, working with our partners across the world to remove barriers. As the Prime Minister has said, we want to build a truly global Britain that is one of the foremost advocates for free trade anywhere in the world. While we cannot negotiate and conclude trade agreements whilst a member of the EU, we can have discussions on our future trading relationships. We have announced a series of working groups with key partners and are seeking to ensure that we deploy the right trading tools with each market to take best advantage of the opportunities available to us, both now and as we leave the EU. With some of our partners, an FTA might be the right solution. In other cases, other trading arrangements may be more appropriate. Now, my Lords, I'm keen to address the concerns of the business sector, and I hope I'm able to answer the very important question raised by my noble friend, Baroness Verma. And the noble Lord, Lord Aberdare, asked a very sensible question. What criteria will the government use in assessing when it has achieved a good deal? The key is engagement. The Department for International Trade and the Department for Exiting the European Union have been engaging widely with businesses at all levels since the referendum, as have other departments, such as the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, the Department for the Environment, Farming and Rural Affairs, the Department for Culture, Media and Sport, and HM Revenue and Customs. I thank the noble Baroness Lady Donaghy for her point on ensuring engagement with industry. I can assure her that as we prepare for the negotiations over the UK's future relationship with the EU, the government will continue to have open and honest conversations with businesses and trade associations to understand issues, limit uncertainty, and ensure our new relationship with the EU works for business. The insight we are gaining from our engagement will play a vital role in informing the development of trade policy that works for the whole of the UK. And I'd like to confirm the intention raised by my noble friend, Lord Green. The government is determined not to allow any part or nation of the United Kingdom, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, or England to lose out in this process. The Department for International Trade is dedicated to serving the whole of the UK, now and when we leave the EU, and officials from DIT have been engaging with counterparts in each of the devolved administrations. This engagement is stepping up. Last week, DIT hosted officials from the governments of Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland for an in-depth discussion of our WTO membership, the rights and obligations that come with membership, and the impact that Brexit will have on our relationship with the WTO. The Department for International Trade will be engaging further on a wide variety of trade-related topics over the coming weeks and months. And the government is, of course, taking into account the specific circumstances faced by businesses in Northern Ireland. The Prime Minister has been clear that there will be no return to the borders of the past and that retaining trade will be important. She agreed with the Taoiseach that we will work to ensure as seamless a border as possible with Ireland and to continue the common travel area. We are clear that we want Britain to have the greatest possible tariff and barrier-free trade in goods and services with our European neighbours and also to be able to negotiate our own trade agreements. As the Prime Minister has said, we want to have reached an agreement about our future partnership by the time the two-year Article 50 process has concluded. We do not approach these negotiations expecting failure, but anticipating success. As we've always said, of course there will have to be give and take, as in any negotiation. But a punitive approach by the EU that punishes Britain would be an act of self-harm for the countries of Europe. Britain would not and could not accept such an approach. My Lords, ahead of and before I go on to that, in the, I think some noble lords were concerned. I think, in fact, it was Baroness, my noble friend Baroness Verma, about the costs of leaving and trading on WTO terms alone. In the event that it is not possible to reach a positive agreement, a scenario which the government is confident need never arise, the government is clear that no deal for Britain is better than a bad deal for Britain, because we would still be able to trade with Europe and we would be free to strike trade deals across the world. My Lords, ahead of and throughout the negotiations, we will provide certainty wherever we can and provide as much information as we can without undermining the national interest. Noble Lords will recall that the question of the publication of impact assessments was discussed in detail during the committee stage of the EU Notification of Withdrawal Bill earlier this week. The challenge we face is to get the balance right between enabling scrutiny and ensuring our negotiating position is not revealed. A cardinal rule of negotiation is not to tell those on the other side of how much certain scenarios and outcomes would cost or benefit you. But that is what publication of an impact assessment would do. A number of noble lords have asked if the government is able to deliver Brexit. Do we have the right staff? Will our customs arrangements be sufficient? Well, the civil service is well equipped to deliver the UK's exit from the EU and has substantial experience of negotiations with the EU. Alongside the increase in staff and resourcing in my department, the Department for International Trade, and also the Department for Exiting the EU, as part of the autumn statement, we also secured funding for additional staff in key posts overseas. Our diplomatic network will be absolutely key in delivering the best for the UK. And as I said, DIT is working closely with the Department for Exiting the European Union and other departments to contribute to the government's preparations for Brexit, advising on the implications and operational aspects of EU exit for our trading relationships. At the end of 2016, DIT's trade policy team consisted of around 150 staff. This team of trade policy officials has now increased to 185 and is continuing to grow. This includes policy and country specialists, as well as expert economic analysts and lawyers. We will continue to develop our existing expertise, as well as hire the brightest and best talent, both from within and outside of the UK civil service, in order to deliver the best outcomes for the UK. The Department for Exiting the European Union now has over 300 staff and is growing fast. It is also supported by 120 UK rep staff based in Brussels who report to ministers in the Foreign and Commonwealth Office and the Department for Exiting the European Union. Parliament will, of course, be involved in helping to shape the UK's future as we leave the European Union. There have been 70 parliamentary debates already on Brexit, as well as 36 select committee inquiries. The House of Commons overwhelmingly voted for the Article 50 bill to pass third reading unamended. And as noble lords know, the bill passed through the House of Lords committee stage with an amendment last night. But it will now pass back to the House of Commons, and approval of this bill will provide a key step towards a smooth and orderly exit from the EU. The government will bring forward legislation in the next session that, when enacted, will repeal the European Communities Act 1972 on the day we leave the EU. We will bring forward a white paper on this great repeal bill that will set out our approach to giving effect to withdrawal on the domestic statute book. We will ensure it is published in time to allow Parliament to digest its contents in advance of introduction of the bill in the next session. Now, many noble lords, including the noble lord, Lord Little, and the noble lord, Lord Risby, asked about whether the government would seek equivalence of EU regulations and standards. Equivalence will, of course, be an important part of any discussion on our future trading relationship, and the Great Repeal Bill will convert current EU law into domestic law while allowing for amendment in future. How we go about ensuring the fewest possible barriers to trade between the UK and EU is a matter of negotiation. We will inform the House about the detail and timing of the repeal bill legislation in due course. We've always been clear that Parliament will have every opportunity to scrutinise the Great Repeal Bill, and we are considering the best way to enable that. And of course, Parliament must be consulted before ratification of any future trade agreements that we negotiate. We recognise the importance of access to EU markets. As my noble friend Lord Gadia and other noble lords have raised, financial services contribute more than 7% of UK GDP, and its exports account for over 12% of the UK total. Around half of the world's largest financial firms have their European headquarters in the UK. We are listening to what the financial services industry has to say on the key issues facing them, and will be looking for a sensible discussion in negotiations. On the question of the UK being outside the jurisdiction of the ECJ, we are preparing a UK trade remedies framework for when we leave the EU that will enable the UK to be a leading proponent for free trade, whilst providing a safety net for its industries. If dumped, subsidised or surges of imports cause injury to UK producers, as set out by WTO agreements. The UK remains committed to pursuing free trade. That includes seeking to achieve continuity in our trade and investment relationships with third countries, including those covered by EU FTAs or other EU preferential arrangements. We are actively exploring what may be possible with our trading partners to achieve this. I want to respond to some of the points raised by my noble friend Lord Green in regard to UK trade statistics. In 2016, UK exports were £544.8 billion, up by 22.6% in 2010. And whilst there was a trade deficit in goods last year, there was a £98.1 billion surplus in trade in services. This is a positive picture, but of course the government wishes to build on it and also look to ensure that the benefits of trade reach as many across the UK as possible. Many have commented on the complexity of the task ahead, and I can assure my noble lords that the government does not underestimate it. The government does not and must not do this alone. We must take a whole of the UK approach, drawing on the skills and expertise of the members of this House and the other place, and the key learnings we can draw from business and civil society. I am confident that if we seek to work together, we can get the very best outcomes for the UK. To conclude, I'd like to thank noble lords for their contributions over the course of this debate. And I'm sure that this House will continue to play a valuable role and work pragmatically together towards building our future.
My Lords, I thank the Minister for that contribution to the debate. I also need to thank her for actually being here and to join her in sending birthday greetings to Lord Price. I would like to gently say to her, though, that there wasn't much new in that, and that I would have hoped there would have been a little bit more engagement in some of the points noble lords made. I think one of the difficulties as we go forward in this House and in Parliament generally is that if the governments continually repeat the same phrases, it will increasingly sound like whistling in the dark. It may be whistling in the dark to keep their own spirits up, or it may be to make sure that we don't quite know what's going on. But either way, we need a little bit more than that. It was a good run through, but it was only a run through of things we have, generally speaking, heard before. There was one little bit, though, I thought might be new, and I'm not sure whether Lord Lansing would agree with me, as interesting customs. I thought the phraseology on the customs union was actually slightly different, and I will look at the precise text on that and see if there is a new measure there. My lords, I'm not going to make a great speech tonight. I thank everybody who's participated in the debate. I thank perhaps in particular those who've joined us, Lord Gardner's contribution, Lord Mendelssohn, and others who had not participated in the debate. Everybody else, I think, who spoke had participated in the committees. And I thank them very much for their work, as I thank, again, the staff. I just wanted to mention one thing in relation to staff. The clerk to our committee is actually left for separate duties this very week. Separate duties in this house, Alicia Cunningham, and I'd like to thank, put on record in this debate the work that she has done for us. I just say two other things, my lords. One, of all the experts who were going to be quoted in this debate, I hadn't expected Lord Tyson to be one, Mike Tyson to be one of them. But my lords, knowing how the EU negotiators react is an important missing part of the jigsaw in most of this debate. There was a point in one of our debates, Baroness and I will probably remember it, when one of our colleagues said, he was a noble and gallant member of the House, but he did say, in these situations, I like to see it through the eyes of the enemy. Now, that may be going a bit far. I prefer the term counterpart, but nevertheless, did not get much inkling during the course of our discussions with government that they were really getting enough intelligence on where the EU are coming from. My lords, one of the things my noble friend Lord Lee and my noble friend Baroness Donoghue will remember our irritation when in trade union discussions, when the press always say that the trade unions make a demand and the employers make an offer. But the reality of this is that's how Europe sees this. We are the demander. They have to deign to make an offer to us. Now, they have interests to preserve, but the interests are not necessarily the same as ours. We want to maintain a good relationship, and so do they. But they see us as the people who are walking away and, to some extent, stopping paying the rent at the same time. Now, we start from that psychological disadvantage. And if we do not try and understand and cultivate a better understanding of our position amongst our, I'll still call them for the moment, our EU partners, then this negotiation will fail. And I do hope the government are up to this. The other thing I would say is we do need proper engagement in this Parliament. We are going to discuss parliamentary scrutiny again on the bill, but whatever the results of that, there has to be a greater degree of candour, I think, between the government and Parliament as we go through this process. We do not expect you to give your total negotiating hand to the world at large. But my noble friend Lord Lee said our report was ruthless and realistic. I think he said it about the report.
Ruthlessly realistic.
Oh, I thought, yeah. I thought for a moment he was talking about me, and it would have been the nicest thing he's ever said about me. But my lords, we need to be realistic. And some of the statements by government are self-evidently not realistic at this point. If Parliament is to be taken with you, if this House is to be taken along with the government during this very, very difficult process, then we need to have an honest and realistic discussion of what the options are and how we're going to deal with them. And we need that on a systematic basis. And I hope the government have taken that lesson from this debate. Certainly we in our committees will be both honest and realistic, and also recognising the limitations. But, my lords, the government will not get through this if they do not get parliamentary support. That includes both houses. I hope they recognise that, and I hope we can therefore have perhaps slightly greater engagement than we've had so far with ministers and with government, and that way maybe we can get through this very difficult process. But in the meanwhile, my lords, I thank everybody who's participated, and I beg to move.
Question is, this motion be agreed to? As many as are of that opinion will say content. Contrary, not content, the contents have it.
My lords, I beg to move that the House do now adjourn.
That the House now adjourn.
Ended. The proceeding has ended. The proceeding has ended. The proceeding has ended.